Afternoon turning to evening in Tuscaloosa at Bryant-Denny Stadium. We welcome you to Alabama's home opener here on Crimson Tide pay-per-view. Mario Cristobal, the head coach of the Panthers of FIU, his third season as the head coach of that program. Former Miami Hurricane has faced off against the Crimson Tide twice in his career as a player, first time as a head coach. Of course, also in his third year at his school, Nick Saban, the University of Alabama, the 27th head coach in University of Alabama history. Last year led the Tide to a perfect 12-0 regular season, back-to-back recruiting classes that have been ranked number one in America. That is turning into wins and high rankings on the field for Alabama. Series history, a brief one. It's a young FIU program as well. Crimson Tide winning the last meeting, the only meeting between these two programs back in 2006 by a final of 38-3. 83 degrees, feels a little warmer than that, but as the sun has set, a breeze has worked its way through and become a rather pleasant evening here in Tuscaloosa. The south end zone looking much different from what it did a year ago. It will look extremely different 1 year from now. This is all part of an $80 million project currently underway. It will push capacity to over 100,000 with an additional 36 skyboxes and 1,700 club seats at the University of Alabama. That will make it one of the top five largest on-campus facilities in all of college football. Growing, growing, growing. That is the Alabama program under Nick Saban. He has lit a fire under this University of Alabama, not just football team, Tyler, but the entire football program.
It seems like so many things are coming together at once. The president is wanting to increase enrollment. We have this huge drive, a capital campaign to improve all the facilities in the athletic department. And then Coach Saban comes in and gets the team winning once again, that kind of snowballs everything else, and they're all just exploding.
You got to have the trifecta: president, athletic director, and head football coach at a school like Alabama. And the Crimson Tide and the University very fortunate that that is in place with Robert Witt, Mal Moore, and the aforementioned Nick Saban. They are excited about the home opener for the Tide. The Golden Panthers are just excited to play football. They were watching last week. But, Tyler, they didn't get a ton of time to work in all actuality. Bad weather down in South Florida forced them to miss a lot of practice time and really juggled their schedule, and even that didn't cooperate.
Not blessed with the indoor facility. Therefore, they are victims of bad weather, and anytime lightning strikes, forced to get off of the field. So they did lose some practice time.
The pooch kick by FIU will be fielded at the 35-yard line by Alabama. And very quickly, the Golden Panthers opting to stay away from Bama's speedster, Javier Arenas, who finds his unintentional return man, Damian Square, and says, "Nice job, big fella." The offensive line, a lot of big fellas, and a good job up front a week ago. In the backfield, we'll see if officially Greg McElroy gets his first start. That's because the Tide opened in the Wildcat formation a week ago, and he wasn't under center. Mark Ingram took the direct snap. It will be Upchurch who will get the first carry of the game, and he bounces it to the outside, and a good job by the Golden Panthers to string it out and keep him to a gain of less than a yard. Defensively, for FIU, Armon Willis at one end, the other occupied by Cody Pelissier. The linebacking corps anchored by Toronto Smith in the middle. And there you see the secondary, Anthony Gator, a good one at left corner. McElroy, the short drop. There's Julio Jones. He had four catches a week ago. And Tyler, very early, the Tide finds number eight.
And I tell you who sets this play up, though, is actually Hanks, number 15. The inside slot receiver does a good job not allowing the linebacker for FIU an opportunity to get up under this slant pass. So good second down completion for Alabama.
So sets up third and short. They'll go with a single back set. That's Upchurch. We told you Mark Ingram, the reigning SEC Offensive Player of the Week, missed a couple of days of practice because of the flu. And Nick Saban opted to go with Upchurch. Those two have been interchangeable. But this time, it looks like the Golden Panthers may have kept Alabama from picking up that first down. It's going to be very close, and it will depend on the spot. Penn Wagers, our lead official for today's game, and they will have to bring the chains over to check the game. Justin West, 6'1 senior at defensive tackle, among those there to make the stop. It took Alabama's offense a while to get going last week against Virginia Tech. A big part of that, a very good Virginia Tech defense. Another reason, three starters on the offensive line making their debut in an Alabama, making their first starts in an Alabama uniform.
Yeah, now those three starters, though, have a full game under their belt, so you're looking to cut down on the number of mental mistakes that they've made. Everyone should work better together here in this second week of football.
Tattle, they also have a very impressive fourth quarter to build off of in terms of confidence. How much of a help is that going into week two?
You know, just the way that they were able to bounce back after Virginia Tech came back and scored and took the lead. Back and forth battle, but they didn't give up, and they were able to finish the ball game like Barry Krause was talking about.
Two tight end set. They run it to that side with Upchurch. Colin Thiep and Preston Dial overloaded to the left side, and Alabama able to run that direction for a big game.
You know, this was a concern last week. Tight ends missing blocks and not getting their guys that would have sprung Ingram and Upchurch for big gains. Here they do a great job locking onto their defender. And as you mentioned, Upchurch with those big, strong legs just fighting his way forward.
See his numbers from a week ago. Had a couple of great runs. Had an unfortunate fumble, though, inside the red zone that Alabama was able to bounce back from. They'll go on the reverse. There is Julio Jones. First time we've seen him in that type of situation, Tyler, but you knew that that was going to come at some point.
Well, it's a matter, and I like the call here on second and short, because FIU's obviously thinking the way that Alabama plays physical football, they're just going to pound it up the middle. Little end around right here, one block away from possibly being even a bigger gain, but a good call there on second and short.
So first down, Alabama, their second on this opening drive. You got McElroy actually split right. Upchurch, the Wildcat. Terry Grant in the game, but Upchurch will keep it himself, and he will pick up good yardage down to the 30-yard line. Anybody thought that the Wildcat formation would be exclusive to Mark Ingram? Didn't really know a whole lot about the different weapons you've got on this Alabama offense, and I've got a feeling it's a package that can be used with others than number five as well.
I tell you what else he did really well right there is he went with the receiver. He went with Terry Grant across, therefore selling that end around. That Terry Grant going on the corner froze the defense for just a step.
Earl Alexander, the wide out to the top of your picture, with Jones in the slot, Darius Hanks to the near side on play action. McElroy with all day. Wanted to load up. Instead, he'll wait. He finds Alexander, and he's got another first down inside the 20-yard line. Puts it at the 19 of the Golden Panthers. You saw the patience there of McElroy as FIU had Alabama covered pretty well initially, but ultimately number 12 found his
man. Barrett Jones pulls around there and offers good protection. McElroy, he has that clock going off in his mind. He's able to get out. But watch right here. This is great. Just patience, as you mentioned, catching the ball, pulling it in. It's like he got twisted up there at the end, though, and he's going to hobble off to the sideline.
Trent Richardson into the ball game. The freshman, one of the most highly touted players in America, lowers his shoulder, runs over a tackler, and he picks up 7 yards. We didn't see him until the final series of downs for Alabama a week ago, Tyler, but Nick Saban had said all week long he wanted to see the ball in the hands of number three more frequently. He picks up 8 on his first carry here in the opening quarter.
And you like how he's getting in here in the first quarter, first drive of the ball game. Things are even. FIU is playing with all that energy, so he's getting to good game time experience.
Mays in the game to the top of your screen. The give, though, to Richardson again. He'll lower his shoulder again. He'll keep the legs churning, but FIU does a nice job of slowing down Richardson, the 5'11", 220-pound freshman out of Pensacola, Florida, and Escambia High School. He gets the first down as they move the chains again.
Well, the entire line does a great job, though, of that initial push that allows Richardson to get close to the first down marker before contact is made.
A lot of people will tell you this is the top running back in America coming out of high school. certainly put a big smile on Nick Saban's face on National Signing Day when he sported the Alabama hat inside the 10 down to the 5-yard line. It was already first and goal from the 9 and now second and goal from the 5 as Richardson bulls his way forward. Well, we'll say this. He has now had, I believe, 6 carries in his Alabama career. They have all been for positive yardage. That's a nice way to start things off.
That's not a bad way. You know, 3 carries for 10 yards last week versus Virginia Tech. Pretty close to surpassing that already.
Parade All-American. Just one of the national honors that he earned. The cutback. Okay, 6 out of 7 ain't bad. In terms of positive yardage, he may have lost a half yard on that play. It'll be third and goal as Toronto Smith, the middle linebacker, joined with Scott Bryant to make the stop of Richardson.
Either Cody Pelliser or Justin West for FIU once again. Just very quick off the ball, able to beat the Alabama offensive line to the point of attack.
Two tight end look again with Peak and Dial to the left side. McElroy looking, throwing in and out of the hands of Julio Jones. Don't know if that was deflected or not. You had pretty good coverage by the Golden Panthers, as we'll check it out again.
Real good coverage, but a great throw. You know, if this ball is a step behind Julio Jones, run the risk of it getting intercepted or surely battered away. I think Jones just missed that one.
I think you're exactly right. It was on the money, but Julio dropped that one. Peter Riley was in coverage, but he was a step behind. And now we will see Lee Tiffin come on, who made 4 of 5 and was recognized nationally for his effort. It's a chip shot. He boots it through, and Alabama has now taken a 3-0 lead with 9:02 to go in the opening quarter of play. Solid start for Alabama. The Tide rolling to a 3-0 advantage here in the early moments of quarter number one on Crimson Tide pay-per-view. A lot to smile about early on for Alabama fans as the Tide is able to march down the field. A 13-play, 55-yard drive that chewed up 6 minutes, capped by the 23-yard field goal from the foot of Lee Tiffin. Julio Jones had one go in and out of his hands. That would have been a touchdown on the previous play. Tyler, all in all, not a bad start. I know Coach Saban wanted to play a lot of guys. Spotter Mitch Dobbs pointing out that there were 12 different players at the skill spots, quarterback, tight end, wide receiver, running back, that saw action on that first drive.
Pretty impressive way to start. And I tell you what, on the initial start, very impressed with the third down conversion. Now, how many times have we seen in years past where a team like FIU, who everyone thinks we should beat pretty convincingly, we come out, struggle initially, don't pick up points on the first possession, and kind of get bogged down offensively, mentally.
Nice to see the quick start. Not perfect, but not bad either. See if the Alabama defense can follow suit. The deep men for FIU, and that is the guy to really look out for, T.Y. Hilton. On kick returns last year, averaged almost 24 yards per return. He busted one for 90 yards and a touchdown. Not be at all surprised if number 99 tried to keep it away from number 4. The other deep man there is Junior Mertil, and he will be the one that actually gets the opportunity at the 10, at the 12, at the 14, and no further for Mertil. Rod Woodson was the first guy to make the hit a week ago in kick coverage. The true freshman out there to make the hit again for Alabama. There's your offensive front. Pretty good tackle to tackle. Again, 10 of 11 returning offensive starters for Mario Cristobal's squad. Perry, the most experienced return man, but Hilton, again, very dangerous as a wideout. It listed officially in the H-back. You'll see him quite a bit in the return game as well. A fifth-year senior at quarterback in Paul McCall threw for over 2,300 yards last year and 15 touchdowns, and they will start with the empty set, 5 wideouts. And you'll see a lot of this today. You'll also see the ball on the ground, and that's about the worst way it could have started for the Golden Panthers as Bama gets a freebie there, a loss all the way back to the 5-yard line.
Yeah, this is a classic case of looking downfield before you have the ball in your hand, and he knows the rush is going to get to him eventually, so he goes ahead, jumps on it. He'll live to see second down.
But he will see second and 20. After about a loss of 9.5, almost 10. They'll leave a setback in. Well, protect as the snap is taken from the gun. They'll hand it off. And not much running room there either. Terrence Cody says, welcome to Tuscaloosa, Darius Perry. You got some really nice paint schemes on the turf, and you almost had a Golden Panther embedded around the goal line.
Well, this is a counterplay. It's a design counterplay. They actually pulled the right guard and tackle, but the offensive line had no push up the middle.
Here's your starting defensive front with Marcel Darius starting in place of Brandon Dederick, who missed a good bit of a week because of the death of his grandmother last weekend. Third down and all the way to the 25 needed. Pressure coming, looking for it all. And that one is going to be caught for a first down. Kareem Jackson, check that. Excuse me, it was Robbie Green, I believe, who was beaten on the play, covering 46 yards. Ellingson able to make the grab on the beautiful throw from Paul McCall.
Had just enough time to get rid of the football. This is man coverage across the board. You have a one-on-one situation out here with no help from the safety.
Green was beaten by about a quarter of a step, and then he slipped and fell. And a great grab by Greg Ellington, the 6'4 junior. From deep in their own end zone to right at midfield now for the Golden Panthers, and Alabama will call a timeout to talk things over and settle things down just a bit. A big play early for FIU gets them out of the shadow of their own end zone and now has them working with a short field.
Well, and Saban's mad right now. He's not upset with the previous play. He's mad because of the substitution not communicating with one another.
Barry Krause down on the sidelines. What have you got for us?
Got a couple of players down getting their ankles re-taped. Roy Upchurch, if you're wondering where he was on that last drive, he basically was on the sideline. They were taping up his left ankle. And sitting next to him was Julio Jones. He was getting his right ankle taped up. So I think it's just a little bit of maintenance. I don't think there's any concern. They got up and they were walking around and running, actually. So they look like they're good to go.
Thank you, Barry. And there is Julio Jones. There's Roy Upchurch. And again, Terry Grant, who is still a running back for this Alabama offense, also being used at wideout this week. Nick Saban wants to get 29 on the field. We saw him on that first drive. Did not have a pass thrown to him, didn't get a carry, but you're going to see a lot more of Terry Grant.
He's a good talent. He's a good kid. They're trying to find a way to utilize him. Got a couple of guys ahead of him at the running back position, but maybe they can work him in there at that slot receiver.
Couple of busted coverages last week by Alabama. Could have been devastating, but Tyler, you and I talked about it a good bit after the game and throughout the course of the week. To have the mistakes that you had for Alabama and still beat a team as good as Virginia Tech says a lot about where this team is right now, but also how far they have to go.
A lot of improvement that can be made, and I'm sure that that's what the coaching staff is focused on this week.
Held Virginia Tech to only 155 yards of total offense. Is Tech any good? Well, picked to win the ACC and also a team that beat Marshall today 52-10, I believe, the final score in that matchup in Blacksburg. So after the 46-yard hookup, first and 10 from their own 49-yard line, the Golden Panthers of FIU. Looking along the defensive front, Terrence Cody, a guy that enjoys life, I think is a safe way to put it. He's enjoying things even more in the last 12 months since he's been at the University of Alabama. A huge season last year for the big man. He's done a great job of getting himself into even better playing shape and expected to have an All-American campaign again. McCall on play action. Little wheel route. McLean in coverage and almost a beautiful catch. But it's off the hands of the intended receiver, Darian Mallory. Tyler, there aren't a ton of linebackers that can stay with a running back step for step the way McLean did right there.
Well, he did a good job picking it up. It was man coverage, and FIU actually got what they wanted. You got the one-on-one situation on the backside with a linebacker with no help. But McLean might have gotten away with a little face guarding there as well because he did not look back for the ball. But fortunately for Alabama, it falls incomplete.
Talked about it all day on radio and television as well, Tyler. This is a FIU offense that is capable of causing some problems. Tried a little jailbreak screen right there, and that one was busted up. A lot of traffic in the area where Paul McCall tried to dump that one off to T.Y. Hilton.
Yeah, just did not develop. Oh, the defensive line doing a good job of not allowing the lineman to get downfield. This play never developed. Had no chance.
Eric Anders playing the Jack linebacker and Jack the jaw of Paul McCall right there, the quarterback, planting into the turf just as he released the football. Third and 10 now. Golden Panthers able to connect for 46 yards on their last third down attempt. See what they do here. Bama showing blitz with Mark Barron creeping up from the corner. They pick it up rather nicely, though. The out pass drops. It was Ellington who caught the 46-yarder earlier. That one a much more simple attempt, but he's not able to bring it in.
Oh, but well-placed ball, though, by Paul McCall. Anticipated the break of his receiver. He took a lick after he threw the ball, but the ball was delivered right where it needed to be. Alabama dodged another bullet.
They did indeed. Kareem Jackson in coverage, and that was an excellent throw. Pressure came from Lorenzo Washington. But now Carlos Munera will have to punt. High spiraling kick. Arenas with a nice fake, and thankfully for the Tide, that one will just trickle into the end zone for a touchback. So the Tide will have it first and 10 from their own 20. A 51-yard punt from Munera. And so the Tide will have possession for the second time today. What do you look for offensively for Alabama?
Want to continue to dominate the line of scrimmage. Got to find a way of beating these fast defensive linemen for FIU to the place of attack. You know, a couple plays here on this previous drive, they weren't able to do that. So I look for them to just, they want to continue to mix it up. There's a lot they need to work on, but they got to be able to run the football.
Richardson back in as the single setback behind McElroy. It's the tight end dial shifting to the H-back spot, and now McElroy will look. Dragging is Colin Peake, the tight end, and he makes the catch and picks up an Alabama first down. A gain of a dozen on that play, Tyler. He really showed the pass-catching ability that made him such a coveted transfer a year ago.
This is where he thrives also. He does a great job of selling the run and then just drags across the field. He sees all the open grass. He knows he can continue his route, and that's a nice first down play calling.
First and 10, Richardson again in the backfield. Dial again, the H-back, and the give to the freshman from Florida, and he will work forward for 2.5 tough yards as they spot him just shy of the 35-yard line. Richardson, All-American, consensus five-star recruit by every recruiting service in the country. Virtually everybody had him as one of the top 10 players overall. Top player in the state of Florida, one of the top two running backs in the country. McElroy on the slant. Boy, he put that one on the money, and a great grab in traffic by McCoy. Mike McCoy making the catch, and there wasn't a whole lot of room to thread this needle.
No, he didn't, and he also he threw it right out of the reach of the linebacker, number 44 for FIU. That's Bryant once again trying to get out there and cover that flat route, but McCoy knew he was going to take the lick, but looked it in.
You look at that angle, and it looks like the pass was a little bit behind the receiver, but Tyler, that was the only place he could put it and still make a completion.
Had to, otherwise Scott Bryant for FIU would have knocked it down.
Third about that much for the first. Fumbled snap. McElroy picks it up, and I think forward progress is going to give him the first down. That is a huge break for Alabama. It's oblong, but it bounced straight up that time, and McElroy was able to fight forward just enough, I believe, to move the chains.
Well, heads-up play right here. Almost got tackled by Mike Johnson, but he knew where the play was called, and that's where he ran the football.
Mario Cristobal, a tremendous tackle for the Miami Hurricanes. In fact, he's faced Alabama twice, 1-1,
as a freshman. He was a part of that Hurricane squad that beat Alabama in the Sugar Bowl. And then his senior year, not so much. First and 10 now for the Tide. The slant again to McCoy. Again, a first down. And we talked about that, about this last week. Julio Jones led the Tide in receiving with four catches, Tyler, but it's great to see several players be in the mix in this passing game.
Well, and Greg McElroy, he's surveying the field, and he's not going to one side or one particular person. He's trying to find the weakness of this defense, and he's exploiting it. He's not locked in on one guy. He's trying to take what the defense has given him.
Nice little start, 5 of 6, better than 50 yards passing. Play action, rolling, looking. That's a great feed right there. Dumping it off to Dial. Preston Dial at the 25 and knocked down as he gets to the 24-yard line. 6 of 7 has got to sound a whole lot better to McElroy than 2 of 12 to start the Virginia Tech game.
Well, you know, this is like a naked bootleg. Nobody's going to pick up number 91 Willis for FIU, but he bought himself an extra step by taking a step backward before he delivered the pass to Dial.
So the nice pickup of 19 yards, another Alabama first down. McElroy from the shotgun, looking, dragging again McCoy, and he needs one block from Mays, and he gets it, and he walks into the end zone for an Alabama touchdown. Mike McCoy with his third catch of the drive. It covers 24 yards, and Alabama leads it now 9-0.
Well, the FIU linebackers, they get tangled up in the middle of the field. They just absolutely run into each other right there. That's what sprang McCoy loose. Winston, I don't know if it was Winston Frazier and Toronto Smith, or Smith made contact with another FIU linebacker that was in coverage on McCoy.
Those are your two players, and they absolutely ran right into each other. Initially, thought they just had the bells rung, but instead, maybe something more severe. I thought I saw Smith grabbing his right leg. He is. And you're right. Desiriah Johnson, the cornerback, was in coverage, I believe, on McCoy. And he and Toronto Smith ran right into each other. Thankfully, they both appear to be all right, as they're able to leave the field on their own power. That is a good sign, but also a nice scene on the scoreboard. 9-0 Alabama. Lee Tiffin on to try the extra point attempt for Alabama. Brian Selman, the snapper. Another perfect one from him. P.J. Fitzgerald with a hole. The kick is perfect by Tiffin, and Alabama has a 10-0 lead. 7 plays, 80 yards, 24-yard pass from McElroy to McCoy, and the Tide leads it by 10 early. A lot to be excited about for Crimson Tide fans, as Alabama has scored on each of its first two possessions. The most recent coming on the 24-yard touchdown strike, Greg McElroy to Mike McCoy. How about the start for the Bama quarterback? 7 of 8, 97 yards, a touchdown. And if you want to get nitpicky, Julio hadn't dropped one. It's 8 for 8 with two scores and over 100 yards. Julio will be the first to tell you.
How dare you?
Should have come up with it. But to tie it off to a great start, still Kurt Cignetti among the assistants talking things over. They can always find something you could have done a little bit better. But that is an impressive start. And again, spreading the wealth, Tyler. You've got a catch for Julio Jones for 9 yards. But you got McCoy, who had 3 catches for 45 yards on that drive alone. Preston Dial, Colin Peake, Earl Alexander also on the receiving end of passes so far, and we haven't even wrapped up the first quarter of play.
Now, he's spreading the wealth, as you just mentioned, doing a nice job of taking what FIU has given him, and of course they're kind of picking themselves off as well.
Here's Tiffin. The kickoff again. T.Y. Hilton the deep man, and he'll take it from his five. Hilton at the 15, Hilton at the 20, Hilton at the 30, and that's why you don't want to kick it to him. He is off to the races. Can Julio Jones catch him? 25, 20, 10, 5, touchdown, 97 yards. T.Y. Hilton, that is the longest return of his career and the second score for him as a kickoff return man, and that is why he was one of the best in the country a year ago.
Well, it's not like you didn't get a heads up all week. You knew what this kid was capable of. It looked like Courtney Upchurch missed a tackle, as well as we might have had a block in the back not called. But as you mentioned, Hilton, with that speed, when he gets out, Rodgers can't run him down.
I said Julio. Chase him, you're right. It was Rodgers. Sorry, Julio. And also sorry, Rodgers. The double numbers. The extra point attempt is up. It's good. And just like that, Dustin Rivest, the PAT, after the 97-yard return by Hilton. He scored touchdowns five different ways a year ago. Kickoff return, punt return. Ran one in, caught a touchdown pass, and just for fun, he had what they called the Hilton heave to win a game late. A great talent, again, just a sophomore out of Miami Springs High School in Miami, Florida. And there are a few Golden Panther fans among the 92,000 plus in attendance here at Bryant-Denny Stadium. Something to get excited about early. Something for the Alabama coaches to gnaw on their players about, though, Tyler. This is consecutive weeks now that Alabama has given up a kickoff return for a touchdown.
Hey, you work so hard on both offensive and defensive sides of the football to give up a cheap score in special teams. It can be disheartening. We saw Alabama respond well last week. Important right here that they calm themselves down and just take it one step at a time.
Offense is probably a little bit excited. They get the ball back. They're ready to go to work again after a flawless drive, with the exception of one mishandled snap or bad snap. Couldn't tell initially which it was, but that man knows a thing or two about kickoff returns as well. Although I don't know if he'll get a chance to field one. They're going to kick it short again, and a fair catch is called for, as once again making it around the 38-yard line for Alabama will be Damian Square. Square says, this is not exactly what I signed up for. He's a redshirt freshman as a defensive lineman, but he's done a pretty good job, as has that junior quarterback for Alabama. McElroy leading the Tide to 135 yards total offense. For FIU, of those six offensive plays covering 57 yards, one of them went for 46. And again, there's only one way you could have had a better start for McElroy, and that really wasn't his fault. Play action. He will look, and he will unload it. It's caught by McCoy. It's another first down. If Julio Jones is a decoy, he's been a good one. I'm not even sure Julio was on the field that time. Marquise Mays was the other receiver. That's the fourth catch already for Alabama's Mike McCoy.
Yeah, Mays runs a post route. McCoy runs a little post dig up underneath. The safety goes back. McElroy throws underneath.
What are they doing? Why is he so open right now?
Because FIU is so focused on stopping the run, especially when two tight ends are in the ball game, it opens up the passes.
There's Grant in motion. He'll get the carry around the right side, and that one is broken up nicely by the Golden Panthers. A great job. That is Anthony Gator, 5'10", 175, and a junior for FIU, and that results in a loss of a couple of yards. Busted that one up. May have run right into a blitz that time. I couldn't tell, but the left corner did come up and make a nice stop.
Well, it looked like Mark Ingram actually may have missed a block there.
Good to see number 22 in the ball game. He was in the game at the end of the previous drive. A lot of time for McElroy. There's Ingram, who makes the catch. Ingram looking to the outside. Ingram keeping his feet, 30. Ingram 25, still on his feet, inside the 15-yard line, and they'll spot him down there. It'll be first down Alabama as Mark Ingram with a nice catch, as we saw a week ago, Tyler, that went for a touchdown. He almost turned that one into six as well.
Well, he's a last resort right here, just a little check down pass. But once he gets the ball in the air, he uses his awareness. Colin Peake tries to come and throw a block right there, but is unable to get in front of the defender. And he does a good job of pulling up.
On the tall sweep, Ingram looking again inside the 10. He'll pick up 3-4 yards on the carry. Ingram missed a couple of days of practice this week. His roommate, Star Jackson, came down with the flu last weekend. Ingram caught it. The bug kept him out of practice for a couple of days. They basically quarantined those two guys from everybody. And you can tell a big run after the catch and then a nice run there.
A little winded.
Same way I feel walking from the elevator to the press box.
FIU is confused on this play. I think they're going to go ahead and have to call timeout.
Good decision on their part as Alabama has looked almost flawless offensively on its last two drives. And Mario Cristobal talked things over with his team as Nick Saban will do the same for Alabama. Cook's Pest Control scoreboard shows Alabama on top 10-7. The Tide got a 24-yard field goal from the foot of Lee Tiffin to start the scoring. 13-play, 55-yard drive that took just under 6 minutes. They follow that with a 7-play, 80-yard drive, covered just 3:20. It was capped by a 24-yard touchdown pass from Greg McElroy to Mike McCoy. And then after Alabama kicked off, T.Y. Hilton on the receiving end scampered 97 yards for the second kickoff return of his career. And he gave the Golden Panthers new life, making it a 3-point game. But Alabama trying to get those points back immediately is Greg McElroy, now a ridiculous 9 of 10 for 148 yards. Brings the Tide back on second down and 7 with Trent Richardson now the single setback. Dial the H-back. And you've got a flag and likely a procedure penalty again. The snap seemed to come a half count after everybody else moved.
Yeah, I think Preston Tiles is going to be the one that's most upset.
Prior to the snap, full start, 75 on the offense. Penalty 5 yards, then remain second.
That's going to be on one of those offensive linemen starting just his second game for Alabama. Redshirt freshman Barrett Jones. Tyler, he's a good one out of Evangelical Christian High School in Memphis.
Already thrown a couple of great blocks. Spring some big plays for this Alabama offense.
Richardson in for protection. McElroy dumps it off McCoy. Spinning inside the 10. That'll set up third down and short. Well, we've got a flag in the Alabama backfield. That's going to be holding on the Crimson Tide. Penn Wagers again, our referee.
Holding, number 79 on the offense. Penalty, 10 yards, down remaining second.
That is not a young offensive lineman. That is a senior in Drew Davis. And when you're 6'7", 306, and you make a mistake, it's hard to hide. And the officials picked it up. One thing that was good to see on that play, Tyler, if you saw the block by Trent Richardson picking up the blitz from the corner.
Pressure came and he adjusted. He saw, he recognized it and was able to react to it. That's important for a young player. That will allow you to get more playing time.
Earl Alexander in motion to the top of your screen. McElroy on the handoff. That's Richardson, and he's going to be run out of bounds inside the 20-yard line. May have actually been bumped out right at the 20-yard line. Anthony Gator applying the hit. That's going to set up third down and long for Alabama. Third and about 14 yards for the first. Alabama 2 of 3 on third down conversions thus far. A year ago, Alabama converted on 42% of its third down tries. They've got to get to the 9-yard line to keep the drive going here. McElroy stepping up, dumping it off. That's Ingram looking for running room, and there's not much. He's going to be driven back as he gets to the original line of scrimmage at the 9. He needed to get to the 4. Apologize, misspoke just prior to that play on where that first down marker was. And so Lee Tiffin will have to come on and try a field goal for the second time today, and he'll do so in quarter number 2 as the first 15 minutes are in the book. Nick Saban's Crimson Tide coming out, taking a 10-7 lead, but the Golden Panthers still very much in it here in Tuscaloosa.
All
along with Tyler Watts and our Cook's Pest Control sideline reporter Barry Krause. Chris Stewart with you at Bryant-Denny Stadium in Tuscaloosa. Nick Saban has seen some good things from his University of Alabama squad, but also some miscues. Barry Krause down on the sidelines.
Hey, Chris, we got an injury update. Julio Jones, we were talking earlier that he got his ankle taped. Right now he's got a bag of ice taped around his knee, and he's sitting on the sideline. I don't think he's going to be back on the field, but I'll keep you updated.
Thank you, Barry, for that Cook's Pest Control sideline report. As number 8 down for the moment, we'll know later if he's down and out for the day. Even though it's a three-point contest, with all due respect to the opponent, because nobody is chalking this one up as a W just yet, you're going to err on the side of caution this early in a ball game, this early in the season.
Yes. Sometimes you just have to say yes. Stick him on the sideline. If things get tight, maybe he can get back up. They're trying to prevent swelling right now and further injury.
29-yard try from the snap of Snellman. The hold of Fitzgerald. The kick by Lee Tiffin. He's had a great start to the year. 6 of 7 on field goal tries. And Alabama has extended its lead now to 13-7 with 14:55 your time remaining here in the opening half of play. In some circumstances, you'd be very concerned. Julio Jones on the sidelines, but Alabama's already gotten into a rhythm offensively that does not involve number 8 so far.
No, other than the first drive, we haven't seen him at all, and we've still been able to move the ball very nicely through the air. You found your tight end. You found McCoy has come on very nicely. It's a matter of time, I'm sure, before Darius Hanks is able to get involved as well. So plenty of other guys stepping up. As we mentioned, a lot of young players getting that opportunity. We'll see what they're able to bring to the table as well.
23 and now 29-yard field goals by Tiffin. 24-yard touchdown pass from Greg McElroy to Mike McCoy. That's accounted for Alabama's scoring. The only point production for FIU has come from that man, T.Y. Hilton, who went 97 yards with the last kickoff from Lee Tiffin. He is the lone deep man, as he was on the previous kickoff, and you see the scoring drive taking a little more than 3 minutes as it's capped by the field goal from Tiffin, who will kick off again for Alabama, and that one will go out of bounds, and that is not exactly what you wanted either. You're trying to kick it away from Hilton, but row 4 is not exactly where Nick Saban wanted it.
On the kicking team, ball replaced at 40.
And that
first
is
down.
The big reason why. This is not the old days where you get it on the 35 or the 30. Nope. That one stings when you kick it out of bounds. Not as bad as a 97-yard kickoff return does.
All offense has to do is go 25, 30 yards before they're in field goal range as a result.
Again, that's another mistake that in a tight ball game can beat you. Right now, it is a tight game. It's a 6-point contest as we have virtually all of the second quarter still to go. Paul McCall, the fifth-year senior at quarterback, connected for 46 yards on a big gain in the first drive by the Golden Panthers, and he saw something that he didn't recognize, and he'll come over and ask Mario Cristobal, hey, what was it you said Gino Toretta would do in this situation? Cristobal says, that's what Gino did. Good decision on your part. 5 seconds into quarter number 2, and the Tide leads it by 6.
1 individual can change the world. At the University of Alabama, you join a time-honored current that carries you forward through achievement, tradition, and pride, ultimately to become a great, unstoppable force. The University of Alabama, touching lives.
Having an opportunity to be significant, to accomplish some things that had not been accomplished, to sort of blaze your own trail, is something that I don't take lightly. I know that there's a lot that goes into that. There's a lot of hard work that needs to be done. But I promise you this, there'll be no one that will work harder, be more dedicated than I will.
Saw some number ones, yep. Number four is not bad. Number one is where Alabama resided the majority of the year last season. Actually held the number one spot longer than anybody else in the national rankings throughout the regular season. Started the year at number five, moved up to number four after beating Virginia Tech. And the Crimson Tide just looking for win number two right here. They lead Florida International University, which prefers FIU as their name. So we will accommodate by a score of 13-7 with 14:55 remaining here in the first quarter of play. We mentioned number five spot in the rankings, the one that occupies it at the moment, will not next week. Houston upsetting Oklahoma State in Stillwater, 45-35, I believe the final score in that contest today. And Houston led that one early, and you and I were doing the pregame coverage for Alabama's Crimson Tide Sports Network and saw that game, and you thought, well, surely Oklahoma State will get it going. They did offensively, but the defense never stopped Houston. So from their own 40, crowd making a little noise as McCall will snap it with seven on the play clock. They dump it off, and that's a great call and great execution. They got a first down and more across midfield into Alabama territory at the 44-yard line. They went to Frierson, the wideout, 5'9", 183, and a junior as they slipped him back across.
Well, the screen took a little bit of time to set up, but once it did, it worked well for FIU. A lot of man coverage by Alabama to this point.
Inside handoff, flag on the play, very little running room there as you had Marcel Darius and Lorenzo Washington combine on the stop. Penn Wagers and crew been awfully busy here in the first half so far. Mario Cristobal is wanting a little bit of an explanation.
Cliff, number 50 on the offense. Penalty 15 yards from the previous spot. That remains first.
That is very rare to see on a running play between the tackles.
What you're going to see is right there, just
trying to cut
get
down.
In front, just try to cut block.
Trying to cut down Hightower. And they flag Joe Alajajian. Excuse me, Alajajian. The tackle as they dump this one off. That's Hilton, and he's going to be brought down just shy of midfield. We've seen him in kickoff returns. We've seen him as an H-back and now catching the pass.
Here they go. They trade him off and he's able to find a little pocket there. Marcel Darius doing a good job chasing the ball carrier down, getting in on the tackle as well.
Pretty good for a down lineman.
Tyler. A lot of hustle. Of course, when you're as deep as Alabama is at defensive end, you better be hustling.
There is a guy behind you that can play just as well on the sideline, and that's the thing, is Alabama's had some great recruiting classes, and yet Nick Saban still will play a lot of young people. There's a deep ball. Kareem Jackson in single coverage there to get him for pass interference. I think he knocked it away cleanly with the right hand, Tyler, but that left hand may have been the reason for the flag.
You're always going to have a defensive back wanting to keep tabs of where the wide receiver is. He looks back for the ball just like he's supposed to, but he's trying to keep, understand exactly where the receiver is with that left hand. There's a lot of hand checking going on.
Number three on the defense. Penalty 15 yards from the previous spot. Automatic.
Right hand.
First down.
And I understand what he's talking about because he's saying, hey, wait a minute. He took my hand and pushed it behind me and I lost my balance.
May be the case, but the penalty will indeed go against the Tide. And this is going to do nothing but help FIU, Tyler, because they've shown they can throw it down the field effectively, and that's going to stretch that Alabama defense.
That is.
or so you would think. They do pick up 3, 4, 5, actually maybe 6 yards to the 30 now. Is on the carry. Once again will be Darriott Perry. 31 carries, 175 yards, a couple of scores. In just 2 games last year.
You got to think about this also. This is just FIU's second possession. So we're still seeing some things out of them that we have not had an opportunity to get over the sideline and adjust to.
Second and 3. They'll swing it out right side. Catch is made, but not much running room as Rolando McClain is able to chase Perry out of the backfield, and he'll bring him down for a loss of a yard on the play.
Marquise Johnson is going to bring pressure from the bottom of your screen. Force McCall to get rid of it probably before he wants to, but man coverage once again, and McClain does a good job in coverage.
So third down and about 4. Third down and a long 3, maybe 4 actually, for FIU as they'll dump it across the middle. Hilton with a lot of running room, 20. Hilton 15, Hilton 10. Hilton finally brought down shy of the 5-yard line. But again, the Golden Panthers will move the chains inside the Alabama 10-yard line.
Well, this time it's Alabama's turn for the backers to run into one another. Marquise Johnson, didn't see it, it was at the top of your screen there, but he's the man in coverage and gets knocked down and taken out of the play.
Both sides will tell you it's not a pick play if the officials don't call it.
It's not a pick play if those guys run into each other with 5 yards off the defender.
So first and goal for FIU from the Alabama 6-yard line. McCall, the give to Perry. And looks like Darius was the man to get him again. Excuse me, that is Eric Anders coming off the bottom of that pile. The Jack linebacker making the stop. These will be 6, now 7 very difficult yards to get, you would think, for FIU as they don't have as much real estate to work with, and Alabama's defense awfully tough. The play clock now under 5.
Got to watch that little slip screen once again, though.
By mistake. The camera was just shifted. It was not under 5. They now have it at 9. McCall with nowhere to go. Mark Barron making the stop.
This is the new era option right here. Quarterback has the option of pitching to the running back or a little shuffle pass up underneath. But that front 4 for Alabama with a good surge takes that inside pitch play away.
So now 3rd and goal, this time from back at the 9-yard line. They've lost yardage since setting up 1st and goal. At the 6, consecutive plays have lost 3 yards. Empty set with 5 wideouts. Looking, throwing, pass, caught, touchdown, Golden Panthers. Frierson, check that Ellington, who had the 46-yard grab on 3rd down earlier in the game, makes that touchdown catch. And the Golden Panthers have stunned the crowd at Bryant-Denny by tying it at 13.
Well, this man covers. This ball is thrown the only place that it can. Mark Barron in pretty good coverage, but the ball thrown the opposite side, and Nelson does a good job just going up there and grabbing it.
Dustin Reves to kick. Paul McCall the holder. And this one will get the attention of the college football world as FIU has taken a 14-13 lead over 4th-ranked Alabama. A lot of football still to be played here on Crimson Tide pay-per-view. Yep. They're putting on a happy face right now, but Alabama's on the wrong end of that 14-13 score with 10:29 to go in the second quarter. Greg Ellington making the 6-yard touchdown catch in traffic. And Tyler, they have done a wonderful job of going with their strengths. Hilton on a kickoff return got them back in the game after they fell behind 10-0. Their defense held Alabama to just 3 points on its next drive, and Mario Cristobal's team has now taken a 14-13 lead over the number four team in America.
Not intimidated one bit about coming in here and playing this evening, and it is obviously showing here on the scoreboard. Still too many mistakes, though, for Alabama. Too many mental breakdowns on the defensive side, giving up the big plays. And FIU, let's don't forget, has been aided by penalties. But when they've needed plays, especially on third down, they've done the job and they've been able to convert.
That initial drive for FIU had third down and 20 plus from their own end zone is where McCall threw what would be a 46-yard catch to Greg Ellingson, who made the touchdown grab just moments ago. That changed field position. Alabama got points. They didn't get a touchdown, though. Here's Arenas with his first chance at a return today, and Javier Arenas will get it across the 30 to the 32-yard line. First time he's touched the football as they had 55 yards and the one touchdown. But now his team having to work from behind as they did a week ago against Virginia Tech. A penalty tacked on FIU. It was offsides, actually, called on FIU, and so they will tack on 5 yards to it. Alabama will start from their own 36. Mark Ingram, who did not start the game, is the single setback. Play action, McElroy looking to throw. He's looking deep on the post route. McCoy bump and still makes the grab. There was contact around the 30. There was no flag, and McCoy stayed with it. Great concentration and makes his fifth catch of the night.
Well, I tell you what, Mays and McCoy are working well together. Two post routes. Mays takes the safety out of the middle of the field. It opens up all this space for McCoy. He uses his body to shield the defender in the ball and does a great job coming down for a big reception.
Mike McCoy, a week ago, Tyler, did not have a catch for Alabama. He's made up for it so far. So too Ingram as he rumbles inside the 15, and Alabama marching right back down the field to the FIU 13-yard line.
FIU just guilty of over-pursuing right here with the safety. Ingram recognizes it and does a good job of cutting back.
If I told you Alabama would have a receiver with 5 catches for 100 yards, with 9.5 to go in the second quarter, I got a feeling you wouldn't have guessed Mike McCoy. Ingram on the carry. Stacked up after a gain of 2. It'll be second down from there. Last year, Mike McCoy was third on the team with 16 catches for 191 yards and 1 touchdown. Already in this game, he has 5 catches for 100 yards, a touchdown. That last one had covered 35 on the slant. Alexander makes the grab. That's enough for the first down as they'll spot him at the 2.
Well, FIU is basically saying, if you're going to beat us, you're going to beat us throwing the football. They load up the box, take away the running play, and these Alabama receivers have done a good job taking the lick after they make the catch, but making sure they hold on to the football.
Terrence Cody checking into the game for Alabama. He will not be the single setback, but he will be by far the largest. That is a full house backfield with Ingram running right behind Cody. And not surprisingly, easily into the end zone for a touchdown. Terrence Cody at the more than full back, running interference there, and Ingram gives Alabama the lead again.
I'll tell you what, though, contact not made until the end line. The offensive line with that good push really did a great job opening up the hole.
I'm not so sure the contact was it made by Ingram running into the back of Terrence Cody. We're going to see it again as there is a flag The kick is good, but this flag came before the snap. You're right, there was contact, but I think it was when Ingram hit Cody in the back 2 yards deep.
Prior to the snap, false start, 57. It'll be 5 yard penalty, retry.
Look at it again, Tyler. Yeah, hits it. The only hit was made Ingram's head on the backside of Terrence Cody at the goal line. It almost kept him out. The penalty backed it up. Five didn't matter. Tiffin kicks it through. This is what it looks like to run into an almost brick wall if you're Mark Ingram. Bam. It counts for six. The extra point good. And Alabama leading it now 19-14 with 8:20 to go. There is a flag on the play. Illegal participation call against the Golden Panthers. Too many men on the field. And Nick Saban, by and large, Tyler, I've got to think very pleased with his offense. Correct myself, 20-14 the score after the extra point. With 8:20 to go, they have scored on every possession so far.
He's okay with the offense right now. He's probably still a little upset that he didn't get a touchdown on the first possession. But his concerns right now are steered towards that defensive unit that's about to try that on the field. But I got a feeling they may have been able to correct a few things on this drive.
Again, a week ago, Greg McElroy was 2 for his first 12 passes against Virginia Tech. Now, again, the FIU defense will not be confused with that of the Hokies. However,
illegal participation, 12 people on the defense. Penalty will put the ball half the distance to the goal. Retry.
Curious if Alabama is going to go ahead and chase points and go for the two-point conversion.
I think that's exactly what Nick Saban is going to do, and I think he's going to go for a rerun. He's going to bring Terrence Cody back into the game. And I think they'll try a very similar play and said you couldn't come close to stopping it before. It's coming again. See if you can stop the bus. It's a nice decision as they will move that one. The officials marked it wrong. Instead of marking it towards the goal line a yard and a half closer, he backed it up a yard
and
a half.
Well, but you have two penalties.
That's exactly
you
got
a
right.
False start. That's what stinks to the offense is a disadvantage. You get backed up a true five, but half the distance is only 4 yards back towards it. So that puts
exactly
you on the four
right.
Instead of back on the three.
I think Nick Saban
think
and staff.
Confused. He was thinking it was going to be inside the 3 yard line, and then he would have done this. But
they may have simply forgotten. And Nick Saban's going to talk it over. That is almost exactly what happened. I forgot about the penalty on the previous play, and Nick Saban and his staff may have as well, or, like you said, they may have just thought the math would have worked better in their favor. That's an interesting, yeah, they're discussing math right now.
And a lot of times, you know, the referee will tell you, hey, you take the penalty, this is where the ball's going to be. If you don't, here's where it's going to be on the kickoff.
And the thing is now, they had already determined they were going to take the penalty. So they took points off the board in order to try the exact same play again. And this is where Lee Tiffin is supposed to step up and simply make it again. So it is now at the moment 19-14. Instead of having the ball inside the three and going for two, it's outside of the 3 yard line. And Bama will try the PAT again. Shakespeare would love it. It is indeed much ado about nothing.
I'm interested to see, though, where was this? Is this bad communication from the referee to the coaching staff, or did the coaching staff forget about the previous play? Was it another mental mistake?
Could be. But Alabama does, after all of that, have a 20-14 lead with 8:20 left to go in the second quarter. Take a look at our instant replay once again on that last scoring drive. Tyler, the drive itself, awfully impressive for Alabama.
Majority of it through the air, but Mike McCoy has been the workhorse for this Alabama offense. He's done a great job of creating separation and using his body to prevent the defenders from getting to him. And then Mark Ingram has come in, doesn't seem to be feeling the effects of the flu right now, as he is doing a good job running the ball.
Numbers on that scoring drive, 5 plays, 69 yards. It took just over 2 minutes and capped by the 2-yard touchdown run from Mark Ingram. But Mike McCoy, again, having a sensational ball game so far, with Julio Jones out with some sort of leg injury. 5 catches, 100 yards, and a touchdown. Julio Jones has been on the bench since maybe the second series of the ball game for Alabama. Mike McCoy's last game to have a catch was at LSU. He had 2 catches for 10 yards. His biggest game all of last year was against Western Kentucky, when he had 3 grabs. Ole Miss, 3 catches, 45 yards, and a touchdown. But again tonight, he has eclipsed those numbers midway through quarter number 2. Good to see Earl Alexander get some catches as well, Tyler. He has been used sparingly over the last few seasons throughout his career. A lot of promise for him. Great high school career for Alexander out of Central High in Phoenix City. But now in his junior campaign, 6'4", 212, and he's had a couple of nice catches so far this evening as well.
He has. Came on strong towards the end of last year, but remember, he got hurt in that LSU game, lunging for the end zone. Ball got knocked away, and LSU took over. But as you mentioned, he's had a couple of big catches here this evening and has took hard hits after he caught the ball and held on.
Alabama's offense has been razor sharp. 4 for 4 in terms of producing points. FIU's offense starting to get into a bit of a rhythm as well. Special teams produced 7, and now they'll kick it away from Hilton, and it's going to be dribbled out of bounds by junior Mertil. The last drive for the Golden Panthers, cutting right through the Alabama defense. A little slip screen right there connecting with Jason Frierson. They also drop Hilton across the middle for the big gain to put him inside the 10. They lost 2 plays from the 6 back to the 9, but on 3rd and goal, the connection with Ellingson. His 2nd big grab of this first half. And at that point, after the extra point, FIU had a 14-13 lead. Bama, though, marching right back down the field to regain the lead for Alabama. Now let's see how the Bama defense can respond. Josh Chapman in the game at nose, the slant, and another great grab. Marquise Johnson in coverage, but Ellingson with his 3rd catch of the night.
A lot of height at the wide receiver spot, and they run good routes. They're able to create some separation. Alabama's substituted a couple of guys down the defensive line, trying to mix it up and see if they can find a way of getting back to McCall.
Nick Gentry seeing action now for Alabama. 6'1 sophomore out of Prattville. In on that defensive front. And they will move the pile forward for about 6 yards, moving the chains as the clock stops momentarily with 7:37 to go in quarter number 2. Darian Mallory getting the carry for the Golden Panthers. They spread the field. They throw it very effectively, but showing they can mix in the run a little bit as well. McCall, another screen, but he didn't have time for that one to develop. Did he not have time, or did he not take time, Tyler?
Well, he threw that ball away. Hard to tell. It looked like he had it exactly set up how he wanted. He had 3 linemen out there against the cornerback for us. Ball just poorly thrown.
Second down and 10. You've told me many times, though, sometimes the best pass is an incomplete one. There were a lot of crimson jerseys around. They throw it up again, and it's dropped. He had it in his hands, but dropped by Ellingson.
Got the one-on-one coverage right here. Marquise Johnson's trying to prevent him from getting off the line of scrimmage. I got a feeling this one might be reviewed. That might have been caused by the ground.
Johnson, 5'11". Ellingson, 6'4", and they're using that 5-inch height advantage.
Came down hard on his back, probably knocked the wind out of him.
So now 3rd and 10. They've got to get all the way to their own 49-yard line. Bama's showing blitz. Here it comes. Arenas and Barron, they dump it off in time. Catch made by Roll. He's got a first down. Finally pushed out of bounds by McClain, but not until he gets inside Bama territory at the 46.
And what's so difficult about this offense is the fact that they stretch you vertically, so you have to give them a little cushion or they'll beat you over top. But then they break it off and drag all the way across the field, and wide receiver is going to be a step or two quicker than that defensive back that's having to cover him, and he's having to fight through all kinds of other guys going all over the place. That's what Marquise Johnson finds himself in.
Again, this is an FIU offense that returned 10 of 11 starters from a year ago, and they are playing like it here in the opening half to the 42-yard line. Darian Mallory again on the carry, just a freshman. Nick Saban through the media, and I'm sure directly to their faces in practice and in staff meetings, reminding his team, this one was not a gimme coming in. The media, the fans, everybody else can talk about trying to avoid a letdown. He just wanted to go play well and get a win. You're seeing why he was concerned about T.Y. Hilton and this Golden Panther offense so far. Play action for McCall, and he will throw it up for grabs, and it falls incomplete. That's a heck of an effort to unload that one, and also an enormous break for the Golden Panthers, and a crimson jersey didn't pick that one and go the other way.
Eric Andrews did a great job getting up on him. A lot of strength by McCall getting rid of this ball. He floated it up. That's a dangerous pass for a quarterback. He's very fortunate this one wasn't intercepted.
And the Tide fans wanting a grounding call, but that one was very definitely within the vicinity of a receiver.
And I'll tell you what, by doing that, he saved his team about 12 yards.
Could have cost them in a big way, but also saved them in a big way because it did indeed work out. Now third down and long. They've been dangerous here. They're actually 4 or 5 on third down. Let's update that for you. 4 or 6. Marcel Darius with a sack, bringing him down all the way back in Golden Panther territory at the 47-yard line.
Well, really the first time all night that Alabama's found a way to get in the backfield and apply pressure on McCall. To this point, he's been throwing a lot of three-step quick passes, getting rid of the football, not allowing that rush to get to him. Alabama able to get to him here on third down.
Birmingham native out of Huffman High School. Nunera on to punt. High spiraling kick. And again, Arenas will deke everybody into believing that he was going to make the fair catch and instead watches it bound into the end zone. The second touchback, the second 50-plus yard punt off the foot of Munera. But again, they have both gone into the end zone and resulted in a touchback. It's only 33 yards net on the play. Here's McElroy, who has been just shy of perfect. 12 of 13, 199 yards, a touchdown, and trying to help Bama build on a 20-14 lead with 5:17 to go in the half. They're 4 for 4 offensively, a pair of touchdowns, 2 field goals from Lee Tiffin. Let's see what they do here. Play action, scrambling, and he'll go down back inside the 5-yard line. Mark Ingram tried to keep one defender off of him, but as McElroy turned back, there were some other navy blue helmets there to greet him.
Well, Barrett Jones pulls around once again trying to protect him, and Ingram has to pick up the blitzing linebacker, and I think there was confusion there because Barrett Jones thought he was getting one guy, and Ingram saw pressure, so he went ahead and took it. FIU's able to get to McElroy.
Toronto Smith, who left the game early in the first quarter, or midway through the first quarter, I should say, because of an injury, obviously back on the field feeling much better as he comes up with a sack. So a loss all the way back to the 5. Here's Ingram on the carry. trying to get some of it back, and he'll only get in the vicinity of the 10-yard line, and they'll have to get all the way to the 30 now for the first down. So it was a loss on the previous play of 15 yards. Now third down and 20 for Alabama. Third down conversion so far for the Tide, 2 for 4. Hope you'll stay with us at halftime. We'll talk with Alabama's new men's basketball coach, Anthony Grant. We'll look at scores from around the country and also have first half highlights. That will not be one of them, though, for Alabama there. Mark Ingram making the catch. And the pass only nets a gain of about 3 yards, and Bama will have to punt on fourth and long.
Had the play set up here pretty good. You got your big lineman out there, but Gator for FIU, Anthony Gator, is able to come up and make the shoestring tackle.
So Fitzgerald on to punt for the first time tonight. Bama had scored on its first 4 possessions offensively. Now they'll have to kick it away on fourth down at about 16. Hilton is the deep man. And a high spiraling kick that will send Hilton back inside his 45. He makes one man miss on a second, but not a third or a fourth, as Alabama's there to greet him and make the hit. In coverage, Brian Snellman, the snapper. Brian Snellman there to make the hit for Alabama.
Dre Kirkpatrick also the one that you saw streaking down the field that missed contact.
They're thinking touchdown, I know, here on first down, but in the back of his mind, Mario Cristobal's got to be thinking, let's make sure it's no worse than 20-14 going to the break. And they're probably a first down away from making that the case. Pass to Hilton, and he's going to be brought down in a nice open field tackle by Kareem Jackson. But the middle of that defense, very soft right now for FIU to attack.
Alabama's trying to find a way to get to McCall, and as a result, they're having to do things with the middle linebackers, playing a lot of man covers. Therefore, if they put a running back out in a swing pass or something, it's going to vacate the middle of the field, and they're taking advantage of it.
That was a priority for Alabama coming into this year, improve the pass rush. They did so against Virginia Tech, and they have put pressure on McCall, but the fifth-year senior is looking like it in terms of his poise. All day to throw right here. Second and short, and he will throw it away. Had an awful lot of time, and he got hit by Dante Hightower. But the pass falls incomplete, and that is a nice job by Alabama.
That's the thing. We hadn't gotten many sacks on McCall all night long, but he has taken some hard hits, even though we haven't gotten the sacks here. Play just busts down. He runs to the wrong side, just trying to get out of the pocket, make something happen, and takes a nice hit from Hightower.
So now third and 3. The direct snap, and McCall, the quarterback, kept it himself. Last year, he did have one rushing touchdown, but he's known for his arm, not his feet. But he does the job there to move the chains. Clock stopping as they do so with 2:05 to go in the half. Now the 2-minute mark. As you see on our Charter Business scoreboard. McCall swings it out, and that one is incomplete. Arenas with a big hit on T.Y. Hilton. That was a very dangerous throw.
More of a zone look this time for Alabama. So they're laying back, allowing all the throws to happen up underneath them. McCall recognizes he wants to go downfield, but he understands he can't do that, so he swings it out to Hilton. And as you mentioned, Arenas is there waiting.
Big reason that they are very much in this ball game. The Golden Panthers are 5 of 7 on third downs. Last year, Alabama's defense only allowed 28% third down conversions by the opposition. A big difference here tonight. Perry on the delay gets to the 40, and that'll set up another third, and this one will be about 36, maybe 7 yards for the first down with now 90 seconds to go in there. It's not unusual to call plays from the line of scrimmage, but they are indeed having to really hurry now offensively.
Yeah, clock working against FIU at this point because Alabama has softened up in the zone, trying to keep everything in front of them.
Play clock is at 7. Game clock at 105 as they get the snap off. Pressure coming. A lot of red helmets chasing Paul McCall, and he throws it away incomplete.
Might be intentional grounding. Ball did not get past the line of scrimmage. And he was not outside the tackle box.
Intentional grounding. Number 12. The offense. Penalty will be spot of the foul. Loss of down.
You saw fourth down. Saw Penn Wagers look over at his referee to make sure the ball didn't get past the line of scrimmage before he threw the flag. But a great rush up the middle by Washington and Hightower forces McCall out of the pocket.
Trying to get it to Hilton, who was in the area, but the ball's got to get beyond the line of scrimmage, and once it does not, and as you said, it was not outside the tackle box, that is why the flag was thrown. So the penalty is marked back at the spot of the infraction. And Carlos Munera, who has booted two kicks in terms of yardage over 50, but with a net yardage less than that because of the touchback, will come on and try to pin Alabama once again. You can catch Alabama football replays on CSS Sundays at 9 o'clock Eastern, 8 p.m. Central. Also again on Mondays at 12:30 Central and 12:30 Eastern and 11:30 Central. So the Golden Panthers will have to punt. I've got to think Mario Cristobal would have, again, much preferred. First thought, take the lead. Second thought, let's don't have to punt at Tavier Arenas.
This is Arenas' best opportunity to return the ball. He's got a lot of field to work with. Don't think they can get this one in the end zone.
They're going to try, though. They'll force him into a fair catch as Arenas makes the grab at the 11-yard line, and he was looking back at one of his teammates saying, look, you were a little bit too close for comfort right there. That was the freshman, Drake Kirkpatrick, who almost ran into him trying to keep the gunner off of him and almost created disaster. Woo! That was even closer than I thought.
And to this point, though, the Alabama defenders have done a good job of keeping the gunners away from Arenas. But this time, right when they needed it, they are able to get somebody down there.
Arenas, a Tampa, Florida native. Not very happy with the degree of difficulty on that fair catch.
And don't think Alabama's just going to take this one to the locker room now. You remember what happened last week versus Virginia Tech.
Hand off Ingram. Now you might, Tyler, see them take a knee, because last week I think they had initial designs on being conservative, but when they busted a big play on the ground, it was able to change the thinking on that drive.
You're right. Yeah, pretty conservative call here with a little draw play. Yeah, you're probably right.
Which is, it's the same play they ran a week ago, but it just went for big yardage and let them set it up. We'll see what they do here on second. Again, just the handoff to Ingram. And he will cut it back, and he will pick up the first down, but with only 6 seconds left to go in the first half. Alabama will have to snap it again, I believe, or will they? Don't think so. They'll start the clock, and that is the final snap of the half for Alabama. In just a moment, our Cook's Pest Control sideline reporter, Barry Krause, will catch up with the Alabama head coach. Some good, some bad in the first 30 minutes of play, but the Tide goes to the locker room with a 30-14 lead.
Down and the interference call. You know, that's what seems like it's keeping FIU in the game.
Well, I don't think we're getting off the field on third down defensively. And gave up a big play, which is a lot of field position. The offense has done a nice job of moving the ball, so we just got to get straightened out on defense. We're a little out of sorts with the no huddle, and we got to play the screens better and get off the field on third down and change the field position with some turnovers.
With Julio out of the game, any adjustments?
No, Mike's done a great job. You know, Mike's catching all would have been catching, so he's done a really good job.
Thanks, Coach.
Thank you, Coach. Thank you, Barry. Alabama with a 20-14 lead over FIU at the break. Coming up, we'll have scores from around the country and a visit with Alabama's new men's basketball coach, Anthony Grant. Golden Panthers have been in a fight, but the Tide holds a 6-point lead at the break. On the field to make sure. With Tyler Watts and our Cooks Pest Control sideline reporter Barry Krause, Chris Stewart back with you at Bryant-Denny Stadium, where Alabama holds a 20-14 lead over the Golden Panthers of FIU. And we had talked about team numbers a few moments ago, Tyler. I'm sure Nick Saban not concerned with individual numbers at all, but the 13-14 passing for Greg McElroy, and again, he has put literally every pass on the money so far.
Don't say so far. See, that's the key right there. To this point, he's played a very good game. What if he were to make a bad throw and throw an interception, set up a short yardage situation for FIU in a tight ball game like this? It's where you can't worry about what your quarterback has done or what any individual has done. It's what are they going to do going forward?
You could tell he was not happy with his performance in the first half against Virginia Tech. He admitted that he got a little rattled, which is something that he absolutely has a great distaste for, because he loves that. That's what has been the trademark of this young man in his high school career: patience, waiting on the opportunity to play in Texas, waiting on the opportunity to play at Alabama. And then he got a little bit rattled by a very good Tech defense a week ago. So much more poised and calm in the second half of the game against Tech, and extremely so in the first half here today.
You know, when you're throwing the football as a quarterback, you almost have to be on the verge of really not caring what happens. You have to have that much confidence and be that relaxed and that loose, you know what you're doing, but almost have that carefree attitude and just sling the ball around. He's done that tonight. He's got a lot of confidence. Wouldn't look for anything to change.
We talk about Julio Jones and what he means to this offense, but awfully nice to see Mike McCoy with 5 catches, 100 yards. Mark Ingram, 3 catches for another 40. Earl Alexander with 2 catches. Preston Dial with a 19-yard grab as well. And you also did have Julio Jones with 1 catch for 9 yards in the first half, but may have injured his leg on that 5-yard reverse that he had earlier. We'll check with Barry in a bit on the availability of Julio Jones in the second half. This is very much a ball game up for grabs. Only a 6-point lead. The Golden Panthers will get the ball first here in half number two, and the Tide will have to kick it away and hopefully be able to kick it away from T.Y. Hilton, and they do just that, but it will be good field position for the Golden Panthers, as making the hit on special teams for the Crimson Tide will be Chris Jordan, backup linebacker, another one of those guys that was sick this week and missed some practice time. Craig Brown, the up man, who wound up with the football for the Golden Panthers. So here they come once again. And it was a second quarter especially that saw the Tide on its heels a good bit. Those 16 yards lost in a rushing game, which is basically sack yardage, or else you would have had a 150-yard first half effort from FIU. You see the throwing numbers, the passing numbers for McCall, as he'll work on play action, gets stuck, and the pass falls incomplete. That's a way to limit what they do in the passing game. Put a body out of it. That's exactly what Dante Hightower does.
Yeah, they're trying to get a freebie here on the play action, but Hightower down at that jack position here on first down is getting after him. And McCall is taking a lot of licks. We were talking about it at halftime, taking a lot of hard hits here in the first half. It's going to be interesting to see just how accurate he is here in the second half.
The sophomore from Lewisburg, Tennessee, we talked about it. You come to Alabama, you're going to get a chance to play. Doesn't matter your classification. You can play, you'll get on the field. For Nick Saban, as they'll hand it off, and there's no running room for Darian Perry. Terrence Cody, the man there to greet him.
You know, FIU has not been able to run the football all night long. Here, Cody takes on a double team and still able to fight through it and make the tackle.
A double team and a hold, it looked like. I think the only reason Mario Caraballo didn't hold as he couldn't get a grip on him. It looks like he has a soft cast on that right hand. So third and about 11 now. Working from the gun as always. Looking to throw, but going down again. Dante Hightower hits him, gets the sack, and the Golden Panthers will have to punt. What adjustment could you see on that first series defensively here in the third quarter from Alabama?
Sometimes it's just a matter of getting after it, beating the guy in front of you. If you're on the first three plays of the second half, that's what Alabama's done. Drop back into zone coverage, so they're wanting to keep everything underneath them, so if a pass is completed, let them kill it.
Terry Grant just missed getting a hand on that punt, and now Arenas will have a chance to return one, trying to get to the boundary, but he'll be forced out of bounds at the 22-yard line. Terry Grant fighting his way through and almost blocked that one, but instead the punt will cover 45 yards from Carlos Munera. And here's Greg McElroy bringing the offense back onto the field again. They scored on four of their five offensive possessions. Minus, actually four of six officially. They got the ball back with under a minute to go in the half, and the Tide basically let the clock expire. McElroy from the gun, Ingram the running back. Didn't start the game. He missed again a couple of days of practice because of the flu, but he will start the third quarter and barrels his way near the 25-yard line. Part of the reason that you are seeing him play so much, well, tight ball game, obviously, but also Roy Upchurch left the game. He appeared to be dinged up a little bit in the first quarter. We saw a lot of Trent Richardson. We have not seen Upchurch back in the game from that point either. Second and eight, Bama, with Hanks in the slot to the bottom of your screen. McCoy will dump it off out of the backfield. Ingram. And he will get upended just shy of the 30-yard line. Desiree Johnson came up from the cornerback slot and delivers the hit, but it will be third and short for the Tide.
See Greg McElroy do a great job with his eyes. He's trying to work the middle of the field with his tight end. It's covered up, so he goes ahead and swings it out. That means that linebacker has caved in and nobody's out there in the flat.
How rare is it to have a running back who is as bruising as Ingram is have the pass-catching ability that he does?
He does a great job. He's got soft hands, and he's a threat out of the backfield.
The give? No. Play action. They'll dump it off to the tight end, Smelly, and he is going to be shy of the first down, I believe. That's a great job in coverage there. Anthony Gator, along with Ashlyn Parker, the free safety there, to cut down Brad Smelly, and it will force the Tide to punt.
You normally think as a quarterback, hey, I got pressure in my face. There's going to be nobody out there covering the tight end. But the safety for FIU comes up and makes the tackle.
I believe that is the first three and out for Alabama in this ball game tonight. That's right, it was the second. So Alabama stopped by FIU, and now Fitzgerald will have to punt. Again, it's only a six-point Alabama lead. Beautiful, high, spiraling kick, forcing Hilton to make the fair catch. Contact, but not until the catch was made, and they finally dropped the flag.
That's a push in the back of Dre Kirkpatrick, though. This should not be a penalty.
And that
pushed in the back.
That may be what the two officials are discussing now. The freshman out of Gadsden City High School, Dre Kirkpatrick, seeing time on the field in special teams.
On the play, the kicking team player was pushed into the receiver. Therefore, there is no foul. Disregard the flag.
All right, here's my question. If he pushed him in the back, why is there not a flag on FIU for a clip? I see you have no answer for me.
I don't have a clue. Here it is on the left side of your screen. Right there, it gets pushed into his back.
Not enough contact, apparently, to be... Well, I am going to ask the question. If he makes the catch, if it's not a fair catch, and he returns it and goes right by Kirkpatrick because of the push in the back, that would have been a clip, would it not? And I guess from the Alabama side, you're wondering why is it not a clip there? Or at least a block in the back. It is a moot point now as Bama stops the Golden Panthers for a loss back at the 21-yard line. I'm not saying it's the incorrect call. I'm just trying to get a definition.
It's interesting why FIU is continuing to try to run the football, especially these counter plays. They've just had no success running all night long. I know you have to in order to keep a defense honest, but they've gotten away here in the second half of those quick hitters.
That's got to be a sick feeling. You dance around, you look up, and there's Rolando McClain and Terrence Cody staring you right in the face. They try to go up top, and they do successfully again, taking advantage of the 6'4 range of Greg Ellingson over a smaller defensive back in Kareem Jackson at 6 feet tall.
Same play called here in the first half, just right down the sideline, the one-on-one situation. The coverage, the position is good, but Kareem Jackson has to find a way to turn his head so he can go defend the ball at his highest point.
That's a great point. It is not just because he's 4 inches taller. Those are great grabs on the part of Ellingson and perfect throws by McCall. So the Golden Panthers move the chains, and a missed route there, miscommunication, it appeared, between McCall and Ellingson there. Perhaps he zigged when he thought he was going to zag, and that one falls incomplete.
You know, in order for Alabama to be successful, though, as Coach Saban was saying, that they need to try to set up third and eight, third and 10, third and 12 situations as opposed to the third and three, third and four because of the style of offense that FIU runs.
Second and 10. Rolling. Still looking. And nowhere to go but to the turf as Marcel Darius and Mark Barron combine on the stop. But again, McCall turning that into a positive. He's taken one heck of a beating in the process, but he got positive yards to set up a more manageable third and five.
Pressure once again, though, up the middle with Darius, doing a great job just using his speed, a little twist route on his own. He's able to use those legs, and he follows McCall all the way to the end of the play. Yeah, these are hits, though, that McCall is going to feel in the fourth quarter.
Under 10 minutes to go in the third. Third and six. Ball batted into the air and incomplete. There is a flag on the play. We'll see who this one is against as Penn wagers. He's been a busy man tonight. FIU 5 of 9 on third downs. And this one. You may have a little jawing that was going on. But it was apparently one-sided. Boy, that's a big, big step off there. A hold and then. So they may decline the penalty. The first penalty because it's.
The one is a live play. The other one
is
a dead ball.
So you're guaranteed of a 15-yard loss regardless. It's only a question of is it fourth down or is it third in Northport in order to pick up the first after they step them both
off. I take third in Northport because if you're able to get after them once again, you're going to get good, better field position.
Number 58, that penalty's declined, makes it fourth down. Dead ball, unsportsmanlike foul, number 58, 15-yard penalty, fourth down.
So they'll take one of the penalties, back them up a little bit and make them kick and hope that Javier Arenas can give Alabama great field position. Andy Levine, the man guilty.
And that's the key right there. If you don't get the dead ball foul, they'll back you up, but you still get an opportunity to get some of it back. But the personal foul is dead ball, so they mark it off, you still lose the down.
Here's Munera on to punt. Arenas set to return. One of the most dangerous return men in America, Javier Arenas. Looking for some running room. He will make the grab at the 30. Arenas, 35. Arenas, open field, midfield. Arenas across midfield, down to the 42-yard line of FIU. He is fun to watch. Javier Arenas, the senior for the Crimson Tide, giving Alabama excellent starting field position.
Kareem Jackson does a great job running downfield, creating a little opportunity for Arenas to field this cleanly and get upfield.
Javier Arenas. Another big return, 29 yards after a 48-yard punt, and Bama will try to add to its 2014 lead when we come back. Nick Saban pacing the sidelines as Alabama holds only a six-point lead over FIU. That was our score at intermission. Second series for Alabama offensively here in the second half. And you're hoping from the Alabama perspective, Tyler, that the rhythm the Tide had on its first four offensive series will return. This is now three consecutive in which they have not had punts. Now, again, one of those came with less than a minute to go, and it was at the end of the half. But the offense not clicking as it was early on. Barry Krause, our Cook's Pest Control sideline reporter, what have you got for us?
Hey, guys, really good job of adjustment. You talk about Nick Saban at halftime. Good job on the defensive side of the ball. You saw a three-man rush. They were dropping eight back, and it confused the quarterback. They did a great job. So great adjustment on the side of the ball for the defense.
Thank you, Barry. And we'll see if the offense can turn it into points after the 28-yard return. They're going to go play action and a flag on the play, and you could see the disgust on Greg McElroy's face. They had something going there.
Might have been Barrett Jones.
False start, 75 on the offense, 25 yards. Darren Main first.
Just a little quick coming out of his stance there.
Alabama weathered the storm last week against a top 10 team in Virginia Tech. And I don't think you can say our current 20-14 score, Tyler, has anything to do with a letdown. Alabama's played pretty well, or did so offensively, for the first half. Trent Richardson checking into the game to replace Ingerman. He'll get the handoff, and he'll try to break the tackle. He gets 5 yards back there, so the yardage you lost because of the penalty is regained, and maybe a foot or two more. But this is just a team that has made mistakes. I don't think it's looking past anybody or overlooking anybody. Some newcomers and some veterans with some mistakes that have hurt the Tide in this ballgame.
Well, and FIU, out of, let's say they have 30 offensive plays, Alabama plays great defense on 25 of them. It's just those other five, they're getting big yardage or touchdowns.
Second and 10, they'll swing it out to Richardson. He'll make one man miss. He'll lower his head. He'll run over two more. And that might be the jaw-dropping play I was anticipating coming this game from the heralded freshman for the Crimson Tide out of Pensacola, Florida.
Well, same play we saw earlier. McElroy wants to throw to the middle of the field, but swings it out to his back. That's a great cut right there. Contact's made. Picks up an additional 4 or 5 yards.
4 yards, and he was already on his way down, Tyler, as he picked up that yardage you're referring to. And you got a player down for FIU. And I thought initially it might just be a cramp, but I don't think that's the case. The Golden Panther, we are shielded. Can't tell who it is, but it was apparently Ashlyn Parker, the free safety, 6 feet, 204 pounds.
That'd be a big loss for FIU also. If you'll remember just a couple plays ago, he's the one that came up and made the tackle on Brad Smilling, that third and short.
He may have just had a stinger on that right shoulder. Good to see him able to get off the field out of Port St. Joe, Florida.
Here he is at the bottom of your screen. So he'll be the one that makes initial contact. He's going to lead with his right shoulder. Takes a helmet right to it. You know, pads, shoulder pads are about 3 to 4 inches thick. Well, maybe not 4 inches, but they're pretty thick.
Well, they're half of whatever they were before that collision took place, I assure you.
I told you to lead with shoulder. I got hurt. Why'd you tell me to lead with the shoulder?
Lead with the shoulder, unless it's Trent Richardson coming at you. Then just get lower. And that is the key. And we've seen FIU do a pretty nice job of that in some open field tackles earlier in this game, but just wasn't able to get low enough there. And he took the brunt of that collision with Trent Richardson. Alabama's million-dollar band enjoying themselves. They performed at the half. FIU not bringing their band or their cheerleaders, and a lot of talk during the week. Alabama fans trying to support the Golden Panthers in some degree. I think they're even talking about trying to help the cheerleading program at FIU, save FIU cheerleaders or something like that, is things that we were getting emails and calls about. But it is a young program, but it's a school, Tyler. People think of FIU as a new football program in a Sun Belt conference, but this is a school that's got an enrollment higher than Alabama's. They got 30,000 plus, and Alabama enjoying its largest enrollment ever at better than 28,000 now here in Tuscaloosa. But this is far from a small school. It is just a new program.
And you're in a recruiting hotbed in the Miami area, South Florida. A lot of athletes down there that can support all three big Florida schools as well as some of the smaller ones.
So from the 29, McElroy will work from the gun again. Ingram the setback, with Marquise Mays to the near side. Slinks in the Hanks in the slot up top, looking deep for Mays and overthrown. Pretty good contact between Anthony Gator and Mays. A little give and take from the two, but the ball well overthrown and not able to make the play.
Nice job though by the offensive line and Ingram picking up the pressure from FIU, because McElroy still had plenty of time to stand back there and deliver a nice pass.
Gator's a good one. Preseason All-Sun Belt pick. He had five interceptions and scored two touchdowns a year ago. Now second and 10 for Alabama. Give to Ingram, running room, 25. Running room as he is finally pulled out at the 21-yard line. And it will be third down and short for Alabama. Boy, what confidence, Tyler, when you can go up top on first down. Second down can still be a running play with 10 yards to go for the first.
Yeah, and it's behind Carpenter and Johnson again. They do a good job not only controlling that left side of the line of scrimmage, but Johnson does a great job getting up on a linebacker and walling off the pursuit that allows Ingram to cut it upfield.
See the carries down for Mark Ingram from a week ago, but impressive nonetheless. That one, though, will result in a loss of a yard, and very fortunate to the Golden Panthers, they don't have a late hit, as a completely unnecessary play took place. It may have been Craig Brown, the strong safety, came in and delivered a hit after the fact, but nonetheless, no harm, no foul, and the Golden Panthers turn the tide away again.
Well, they're going to load the box up, and there you see the safety.
Yeah, that
coming
wasn't
in
Brown.
Late.
Excuse me, that was the cornerback, Desiree Johnson, not Craig Brown. My apologies, but yeah, no flag on that one, and it will be fourth and three. And here comes a 39-yard try from the foot of Lee Tiffin. Two for two thus far, six of seven on the year. That kick is up, and he hooked it left.
You don't think that's big right there? It's still a one-possession game.
So the Tide fails to score for its fourth consecutive drive. They do, however, change field position a bit. Now we'll see if the defense, which had its issues in the first half of the Golden Panthers, can pick up the pace again. 7 minutes to go here in the third, and FIU trails Alabama 20-14, and Mario Cristobal coming over to encourage his defense, and he is schooling Desiree Johnson right now, telling him you could have just turned the game around right there with your over-aggressiveness, but probably a good non-call there. Paul McCall, the fifth-year senior at quarterback, on play action, looking to throw, dumps it off. Catch is made. Kareem Jackson tried to knock it loose from Jonathan Fosher, but the sophomore was able to hang on to it.
Play action once again. Now, when Hightower sees this, he's got quarterback, so he comes out. Curious, though, who's got the tight end? The zone coverage, though, they're going to let him go away, and they'll just make the tackle.
We had talked about him as a return man on the first two kickoffs to Alabama, but Damian Square, more comfortable as a defensive lineman, involved on that play. They'll look up top. And this time it's broken up on a nice play by Marquise Johnson.
Perfectly played by Marquise Johnson. He uses his body. He doesn't have to put his hands on the wide receiver for FIU, but runs him out of bounds with his lower body.
And got a hand on the football. It looked like Ellingson was in position, Tyler, to maybe make that grab, but Johnson with a great play to break it up at the last moment. A big third down and three for FIU. They've got to get across the 32 of Alabama to keep this drive going. Bama showing blitz. And they'll rush four, and Marcel Darius will get him. Out of Birmingham's Huffman High School, Darius makes the play, his second sack of the ball game, and the Tide forces FIU to punt it again.
FIU's trying to cross the receivers once again, but the secondary for Alabama just causes a lot of confusion, doesn't allow the receivers to get off the line quickly, and Marcel Darius uses that speed again, as we've seen, to get to the quarterback.
They brought the corners up, did they not? But they still only rushed four that time.
So McCall's back there thinking, I got to get rid of the football. I'm looking for a quick slant, and they're just running all over the place.
A low line drive, and Arenas is salivating at the 30. Javi 35. Javi 40, dancing around 45, spinning to midfield. He'll be brought down officially right at the midfield stripe, and Alabama will have it there with 5:25 left to go here in the third quarter. A 19-yard return after the 48-yard punt by Carlos Munera. Bama with excellent field position when we come back to T-Town. Tide leads it 20-14 on Crimson Tide pay-per-view. 6-point Alabama lead as the Tide will have it right at midfield with 5:25 to go in the third. Chris Stewart along with Tyler Watts, Barry Krause, our Cook's Pest Control sideline reporter. It looked like Alabama might have a chance to run away with this one very early. A near perfect start from Greg McElroy. But a kickoff return for a touchdown kept FIU in the game. Their offense started to pick it up, and now the defenses have dominated thus far in the third.
Yeah, Alabama looking for an answer right here, trying to get something going. Like to get more than a field goal opportunity here. They've ran the ball well. They're throwing the ball well still. But need to find a way to put points on the board.
Greg McElroy in the first half. A fantastic effort for Alabama, as he was 13 of 14, 202 yards, a touchdown. And in fairness, could have very easily been 14 for 14 and two touchdowns in the first half. But a great job of managing the offense. Now, though, Tyler, the onus is on number 12 to get Bama back in rhythm again to get some points on this drive. Didn't ask for a better starting position.
He just has to keep doing what he's been doing.
Give to Richardson, and the freshman pulls his way inside the 45 to the 44-yard line.
And that's a great six-yard gain on first down, running the football. Doesn't look very impressive, but when you get up from the pile and you move the chains, and hey, you just gained 6 yards.
Second down, short four for the Tide. Richardson again, the setback behind McElroy with three wideouts available, and that one is incomplete. Trying to go back to Mike McCoy, who had 5 catches in the first half, but well read by FIU as that pass sailed.
Yeah, ball was high, but didn't look like Greg McElroy set his feet like he had on previous throws. But still a manageable third and four situation.
Third down and about four. 4:44 to go. Third quarter, Hanks, his first catch of the day. That's enough for the first down. He's drug out of bounds by Desiriah Johnson, but not until.
Well, FIU brings pressure. And as you mentioned, Hanks got the one-on-one coverage, does a good job creating some separation and a well-placed ball.
The junior out of Norcross High School in Norcross, Georgia. A big game last week. Big plays in the passing game, something Alabama had been looking for. Not just the nickel and dime stuff, although you will certainly take that, but the ability to hit the home run. You saw that with Mays and Hanks a week ago. Play action, he's looking for it all here. Looking, looking, throwing, and that one's incomplete. And that one looked like you had a mix-up there, as you had two receivers in the same area. The freshman, Michael Bowman, along with sophomore Marquis Mays.
And that's what they're doing. They're trying to cross the wide receivers up and make the safety choose one or the other. But Bowman just busts his route right there, and the separation is not what it needs to be.
And not when the contact comes. Receiver running into receiver. So now second down and 10 for Alabama. Play action again. Looking, dumping it off Richardson. Richardson makes a man miss, keeps his feet, works his way toward that first down mark, and that will be enough for an Alabama first down, I do believe. And another injured player, and that looks like it's Ashlyn Parker. It was his shoulder the last time he went down. Looks like it may be something else here.
Here's a check down once again. Going to Richardson out of the backfield. He does a good job getting north and south. Might have almost got a little too greedy there going sideline to sideline, but still able to pick up the first down.
You saw that one from that angle, Tyler. Ran to a position and stopped. You and I talked about it.
Not being able to do that.
Off air, the fact that sometimes a guy will just run all the way into a defender. This time he finds the open spot. But let's see if you can see where the injury came. Didn't appear to be a whole lot. And it may have been actually Parker hitting the leg of one of his teammates.
Maybe caught a foot to the shin. It looks,
So you can tell one more time on the replay. I was expecting a big hit from McCoy, but
so he's got a brace on that left leg there, though. I think he buckled that left leg.
Yeah, it was after he was down on the ground, Tyler. Looked like he ran into the leg.
I don't think that's what caused it, though. I think that his knee buckled at contact. I think his foot grabbed in the turf, and that knee slid out there, and he might have a knee problem.
I will defer to you when it comes to leg injuries, because unfortunately you were saddled with enough of your own during your playing days, and that is a man who speaks of experience in former Bama quarterback Tyler Watts, and you hope it is not something severe in the case of Ashlyn Parker.
And you know, he's wearing that knee brace. Obviously, there could be some history there. But you're hoping that will protect the player's knee in the event something does happen. Hopefully it is just a foot to the shin, and he's just in a lot of pain right now. But
while they continue to attend to Parker, we invite you to hear the latest Crimson Tide football news on the Nick Saban Show, Mondays at noon Eastern and 11 Central. Get an inside look at Alabama football from the head coach of the Crimson Tide. Take a look back at previous games and hear Coach Saban's thoughts on upcoming opponents. It's only on CSS, your source for Southeast sports. Barry Krause, our Cook's Pest Control sideline reporter, what have you got for us?
Hey, guys, just trying to get an update. Julio Jones is standing on the sideline, but he's walking around stiff-legged. They took the ice off of it, but I don't think he's going to be back in the game. Roy Upchurch didn't even come out the second half, so unfortunately we don't have an update on him, but we'll keep an eye out for him.
Not a good sign, and not good to see Julio Jones on the sidelines either. However, guys offensively, especially the receivers, have picked up the slack, Tyler, in his absence.
Yeah, a lot of talent at the wide receiver spot. We've seen it tonight here with McCoy stepping up and Hanks. Alexander's come through on several times. And then you also have the tight end core with Preston Dial and Colin Peake and Smelly. So they've all stepped up and done a nice job because Alabama has thrown a lot in this football game.
6-point Bama lead, trying to add to it. First and 10 from just outside the FIU 20 to give Richardson. 15 dives toward the 10-yard line, and Trent Richardson almost took that one for a touchdown. Tripped up, but picks up another Alabama first.
Well, this is a great run. FIU has pressure coming off of the edge. Looks like number 44 for FIU. He's unable to make the tackle, though. And, Richardson, that's a great heads-up play.
Hanks in the slot to the top of your picture, along with McCoy on that side. Earl Alexander, the wideout, to the bottom of your screen. The give will be to Richardson again. Trent Richardson will score his first Alabama touchdown, and the Crimson Tide leads it 26-14. He hesitated at the two, and I thought he was looking for somebody to run over. But instead, he finds the end zone, and he'll stay out there as the Tide will go for two.
Watch the job, though, by the offensive line. Sealing off all the pursuit and all the way in the secondary before contact. And you're right. Lower your head to get in the end zone at the one-foot line.
He rushed for over 2,000 yards and scored 26 touchdowns as a senior at Escambia High School. Also a little single-game record of 419 yards. But that is his first in an Alabama uniform. They'll go for two. Ingram in the ballgame. Colin Peake, the tight end, also in there. They'll swing it out near side, looking for Peake, but he can't hang on to it. Bobbled it and lost it out of bounds. A great effort. Not a bad throw either from McElroy, but the two-point conversion attempt fails.
Well, last week they worked Peake on the back end line. This time they run him on a corner route. What concentration.
Wow.
Look at there.
He still managed to get Ian on the ball.
Bryant, you didn't cover anybody. Don't get excited. Would have been one remarkable catch.
Colin Peake, a big target at 6'6", 255, but not quite able to bring that one in. But Tyler, Alabama got the touchdown it was looking for after the defense stops the Golden Panthers, and then Javier Arenas set up the Tide with excellent field position right at the 50.
And doing a great job running the football, mixing it up with the passes just to back the defense off. But the majority of that drive done on the ground.
Bama cheerleaders with something to be excited about as the Tide is rolled now to a 26-14 lead, and the crowd starting to get into this one a little bit more, Tyler.
I think they want to see this defense come out and find a way to shut down FIU's offense one more time.
See if they can. 7-play, 50-yard drive. 2:11 off the clock. And Trent Richardson's first touchdown in an Alabama uniform. Boy, this program's always been built with kids from the state of Alabama. Nick Saban and staff going into Florida, Georgia, and all the other states to get the best in the country. And that's another plus that Alabama has going for it, Tyler. Despite the fact they've had back-to-back top five recruiting classes, and many people think the best recruiting classes each of the last two seasons, Saban makes it clear, I don't care what year you are, if you're better than who we've got, you're going to play. And you come in and work hard and do the job. So they're not only signing these guys, they're finding a way to get them on the field, and the guys are taking advantage of the opportunity. Here's T.Y. Hilton, who scored the first touchdown of the game, and Bama was ready for him on the reverse. And not that they're ignoring everybody else, but there's no question that your ears perk up a little bit when you see number four on the field heading towards that football.
Well, he's the one that can make, that could change the game in one play with his ability to run the football and that speed that he possesses. But Alabama doesn't allow to get him to get to the perimeter.
Second and 10, no gain on the play. Use him as a decoy there and go right up the middle with it to Mallory. And Darian Mallory will get to the 40-yard line.
Eric Anders has had a great night this evening, doing a great job in that down and in that three-point stance, pursuing the football. He's been in a lot of tackles, especially when FIU runs the football.
Third down and 7. They've got to get right to their own 47-yard line to keep it going. McCall running out of time. Dante Hightower brings him down for another sack. The Alabama defense, after having some shaky moments in the first half, rock solid here in half number two.
And it's not really that they're doing anything other than the pre-snap. They're making McCall think that they're in a man coverage. They're coming after him, and then the linebackers are backing out. And he's got this clock going off in his mind saying, I got to run the ball because these routes aren't open. And that's when the speed of Alabama is able to adjust and bring him down.
Munera on to punt again. Another high spiraling kick, maybe his best effort of the night. I don't know if the numbers will show that, but forcing Arenas into a fair catch, and the Tide will start inside its own 20 with a minute 38 to go here in the third. So Greg McElroy and company with such an impressive first half. a somewhat slow start to the third quarter, but putting a touchdown on the board. On its last drive, and Trent Richardson will come out once again, along with Earl Alexander, Darius Hanks, and you see the numbers. Not a bad night for the junior out of Texas. Southlake, Texas, Carroll High School. There's the Florida native, Trent Richardson. And he got back to the line of scrimmage, but not much more than that, as he gets brought down on the play.
Still a good job, though, getting back to the line of scrimmage. FIU really flowed well to the football in the previous play.
Starling Thatcher, man that made the stop, number 99. Here's second down and about nine. McElroy looking, trying to go to the tight end. Contact, no flag. Tyler, the official that was closest to it, I don't think got his head turned around quick enough to see the contact.
Well, I could hear a thump from up here. I didn't know if it was the ball coming off his chest or the defender going in Colin Peek's back.
The umpire not able to get turned around in time to see the contact before the ball arrived, but also nobody on his crew helped him out either. So third and 10, basically, for Alabama with Mark Ingram back in the game. Pressure coming. McElroy will have to unload it, and the pass falls incomplete. Thankfully, a very dangerous throw by Greg McElroy, and that may be the first mistake he's made tonight, but he got away with that one.
Yeah, I don't know if it's a screen call or not, but he kind of flowed that ball up. He took a lick there at the end.
Tell you what,
still able to get up.
Tyler, his elbow came down on the helmet of the defender. Unfortunate if he is indeed all right, and they are looking at him a little bit, but does appear to be just fine as he comes to the sideline. And so P.J. Fitzgerald will have to punt. I believe it's only the third punt of the night for the Florida native, and it is. And boy, a break for Alabama. A flag on the play forces the play to be whistled dead before the snap went over the head of P.J. Fitzgerald.
Dead ball, all sides, on the nose guard. Penalty 5 yards, down remain four.
And Brian Selman's going, wait a minute. I have been perfect on every snap since I've been at Alabama. Let's clarify, there's a reason that snap went over P.J. Fitzgerald's head. He got hit by the nose guard on a running start. That is amazing that he has had that type of consistency. The senior out of Vestavia Hills, Alabama, one of the best in the country as a snapper, but Fitzgerald with a low wobbly kick that does take an Alabama roll initially before being downed by Kirkpatrick at the 37-yard line. Let's check in with our Cook's Pest Control sideline reporter, Barry Krause.
Hey, guys. Trent Richardson just scored his first touchdown in his career, a freshman from Pensacola. And what he did afterwards was he walked over, and for each one of the offensive linemen that was sitting on the sideline, he hugged them and thanked them. I'd say it's a pretty smart move on his behalf.
That is good to know. You know, they always say you got to dance with the one who brung you, and he made sure he knew which guys opened up the holes for him to get to the end zone. And he has played awfully well tonight for the Crimson Tide. Richardson, 11 carries, 56 yards, 10 for 56 for Mark Ingram for Alabama. Here's FIU with an important series late in the third. Pressure coming, pass thrown, intercepted, no. In and out of the hands of Kareem Jackson, and if he makes the pick, he's got a touchdown because there was nobody wearing navy and white on the other side of the field.
I think he's going to be a little mad at Justin Woodall, who may have accidentally kicked the ball out of Kareem Jackson's hands, but this time Alabama gives a different look. They act like they're going to blitz, and they blitz. So McCall confused once again in the backfield for FIU.
It is a very nice call by Alabama's defensive coordinator, Kirby Smart. Second and 10. Bama chasing him again. Square forces him to unload it out of bounds.
Lorenzo Washington comes from the backside and just beats the defender to the ball. Actually, a square. Damian Square.
Yeah. Washington got up first, but it was Square that got to him first. He also had pressure coming from the weak side as well, from Luther Davis. And Mario Cristobal's team face with third and 10. 33 seconds to go in the third. They trail by a dozen, and all the momentum on Alabama's side as well. Heavy pressure coming. Pass, though, is caught, and you got a whistle before the snap, and the play clock may have hit zero. Penn Wagers and his crew very busy tonight.
Dead ball, delay of game on the offense. Penalty 5 yards down main third.
So third now and 15. First down marker all the way up at the 47. McCall with a little time now throws it underneath to Ellingson.
What a play by Kareem Jackson. Ball was underthrown, I think intentionally. That way the wide receiver could adjust to it. Kareem Jackson's trailing, but watch him. He reaches around there, knocks it out of his hands.
They made certain not to interfere in the process. And so now Munera will have to punt again. He's had a great night. See his long of 53 yards. Snap a little bit off the mark, and he now will boom another one, sending Arenas back to his 19-yard line. Javi at the 20, Javi at the 30, Javi at the 40. Javi on his feet, finally brought down at the 40-yard line of FIU. Arenas breaks a big one. On the return, and a flag on the play at the end, it appears. Or is there? Nope, no flag. Great job in protection again, and he doesn't need a whole lot of room, Tyler.
Look at that block that Terry Grant threw there for FIU number 29 at the bottom of your screen. That's what allowed Javier Arenas to cut it back inside and pick up an additional 20 yards.
So 41, and now Richardson. That's a nice job of turning nothing into about a 4-yard gain. And now he is over the 60-yard rushing mark for the night to go with his one touchdown. There's your leading rusher for Alabama in this one as the Tide gets set to go to the fourth quarter. The Golden Panthers of Mario Cristobal have hung tough, but Nick Saban's Crimson Tide holds a 26-14 lead going to the fourth. To the fourth quarter we go. Alabama holding a 26-14 lead over Florida International University. I'm Chris Stewart along with Tyler Watts, Barry Krause, our Cooks Pest Control sideline reporter, Greg McElroy, a phenomenal 13-14 start. You knew we would have to cool down a little bit. 18 of 24, 241 yards, a touchdown. Still not a bad night, but Alabama looking for the blow that might put away the Golden Panthers if they could score on this drive. 15 minutes to play. Bama leading it by a dozen. Second down and 6. Richardson, the lone setback. He'll get the call. Richardson in the open field. And forget it. Trent Richardson has just rushed 35 yards. And Alabama has taken now a commanding 32-14 lead.
Greg McElroy checked off at the line of scrimmage, saw the pressure for FIU. William Vallejos, the left side of that offensive line, doing a great job blocking. Trent Richardson runs not even touched.
35 yards on the carry, 96 yards on the night, 2 touchdowns. And the man out of Escambia High School in Pensacola, Florida,
A major reason why the Tide leads this one 33-14. Lee Tiffin with another extra point. Two plays, 40 yards, 18 seconds. Not sure that constitutes a real drive or not, but it certainly is a heck of a way to start off the fourth quarter. You sense the comfort level for Alabama now. However, finish is something Barry Krause started our broadcast discussing. Nick Saban has preached it since the beginning of last season, but even more so after his Crimson Tide went 12-0 in the regular season, 0-2 in the SEC Championship game and the Sugar Bowl, finishing each play, finishing each game. Certainly they finished that drive very nicely.
Sure did. And that run right there is going to put Trent Richardson just under 100 yards rushing for the evening. So another carry or two, and he'll have his first 100-yard rushing.
Just might get that opportunity here tonight. If you're just joining us, Julio Jones left the game with some sort of leg injury in the first quarter. Has not seen action since. Roy Upchurch also left due to an undisclosed injury. Don't know the severity of either. Hopefully it's not much. And Bama's just giving other guys an opportunity. They have certainly responded. The offense has been very good the majority of the night, as this return will come out to the 24-yard line. Junior Mertil, the sophomore, returning that one across the 20-yard line for the Golden Panthers. Tyler, in a must-score situation, you would think, trailing now by 19 points in the fourth.
And it's going to be a tough task for FIU to do, because this entire second half, they've had no answers. McCall has been confused, not knowing when to get rid of the football, doesn't know where the pressure's coming from, and the Alabama defense has really stepped it up.
He's had to work hard for those 11 completions, but they have been few and far between here in the second half. First and 10 from their own 24-yard line. They'll swing this one out, connecting with Perry, and he's got nice yardage across the 35 to the 33-yard line. Alabama's done a great job of pressuring the quarterback in the third quarter. Six hurries, four sacks on the night for the Alabama defense. They dumped this one off in a hurry there and gave the running back some space.
Yeah, Luther Davis square in there. Don't recognize the fact that it's a screen pass. They continue the rush. Allows those FIU offensive linemen to get downfield and block.
From the 37, a first down now for Paul McCall. Pressure coming. They try to set up the screen again, but hanging on literally by a thread was Hightower until help could arrive. They're going to have to get him a new belt.
Now here's your jailbreak screen where you're anticipating the rush to come up, get them linemen out. As you mentioned, the speed of Alabama, though, able to shut the play down.
I believe that would be classified as equipment failure right there. Not of the Janet Jackson variety, but an issue nonetheless that it does. Second and 12. McCall swings it out. Ellingson making the grab. And now anything they get is having to be underneath. Alabama's giving them a little bit more on the corners. You know, FIU is wanting to score in a hurry, down by 19 points, but Alabama's going to play a little bit softer and give up some yardage, but not clock.
And you're going to force a quarterback who has a lot of experience to be patient and not get greedy and force the ball downfield.
Third down and a long 4 yards to go. Bama showing blitz. McCall trying to check off. Play clock down to three as they snap it. They'll swing it out in a hurry. And this will be stopped shy of the first down. He gets to the 45, but he needed the 47 for the first. And a decision here for Mario Cristobal.
Oh, he'll go for it. Marquise Johnson does a great job, though, getting off his block and breaking down and forcing the fourth down.
They are going to go for it. And here's Terrence Cody trying to hustle out on fourth and two. Bunched up in the middle. They'll run it to the right side, and McCall, it's going to depend on the spot. Looks like he may have gotten it. He was falling as he approached the 45, Tyler, and he's going to be very slow to get up. But that was a gutty effort from the fifth-year senior quarterback just to make it close, and they are going to bring the chains across and measure.
It's an unusual call.
Again, he's...
He may be cramping over there.
He may be. Yet everybody kind of pinched to the inside for Alabama defensively, and they were able to get the advantage they wanted, or so it appeared. But it doesn't look like he got it. Wow. I thought he had it easily at first glance, Tyler, and then as they brought those chains over, well, I didn't think they had enough.
I'm sitting a little to your right, and from my angle, it didn't look like he had it.
Literally. Had they gone with a thinner pig to make the football, Bama would have had possession. First and 10 after the fourth down conversion, so hope still springs eternal for FIU. They'll swing it out. Catch made. Pickup of 4, maybe 5, as Jason Frierson, the junior, makes another grab.
Yeah, McCall's grabbing his toes right now, trying to stretch out his calves. He's starting to cramp. And, you know, that's going to limit his ability to move around in the pocket.
How tough are these early season games? And I know, you know, Joe Fan watching at home goes, well, haven't these guys been conditioning all year long to get ready? But it's still different.
These guys can run at 2 o'clock in the afternoon in July all day long. There's something about the intensity of a football game, though, that absolutely just drains you, drains your energy, and just takes all of the...
On the offense, penalty 5 yards.
It just dehydrates you quicker than anything.
And, Tyler, it's not the physical wear and tear, because virtually everywhere at that level, practice, especially in 2-a-days, is much more grueling than what you get in a game.
Much worse.
Is it the adrenaline flow that you have leading up to a game and during the early moments that may expend a lot of that energy?
Very well could be. It's difficult to hydrate yourself to the point that you need on Thursday and Friday.
Despite the cramps, they asked McCall to run, and he's able to pick up good yardage again.
Yeah, he's feeling it in both legs now.
Their backup quarterback is Wayne Younger, who threw 18 completions on 33 attempts a year ago. And, boy,
Courtney Upshaw does a good job. Yeah, he's reading Courtney Upshaw. When Upshaw goes inside, that's when he pulls the ball.
Did he not just pull the helmet off by the face mask? I thought he had. I think Mario Cristobal thought so as well. It set up third and short after the run. No penalty called. And then a loss on that play. So now another fourth down that the Golden Panthers will have no choice but to go for. Down 3 scores, as you see, with 10:18 to go on our Dreamland scoreboard. Fourth and 3. Four-man rush, but well covered. He has to throw it at the feet of the running back. They may drop a flag on that one. They will. Loss of down and loss of yardage, although Penn Wagers may get a little help from his crew. So incomplete
He had Price in there.
There is no foul for intentional grounding. An eligible receiver on the offense could have possibly caught the pass. Incomplete pass. First down.
They try to run that jailbreak screen again, but Lorenzo Washington, you don't see him there, but he avoids the block, the chop block, and he's able to get in McCall's eyes. But then there's just too much pressure from the Alabama secondary. They were right on Friesen, and they prevented the play from happening.
So the Tide forces FIU to turn it over on downs. Bama will have possession when we come back to Tuscaloosa. Nick Saban's Crimson Tide rolling to a 33-14 lead.
All coaches are like that, and as a player, you wonder why. Well, isn't it more important just to score and the outcome? Well, they understand, though, coaches do, that players have a difficulty. If you execute, you do what we ask you, you do what we tell you to, and you do it,
then you don't have to worry about the score because you're going to score all the time. You're going to score plenty of points.
From the gun, Trent Richardson gets another carry. Hurdles one tackler, and there is a flag on the play. Likely a hold on Alabama. That will negate a run that might have put him at the century mark for the night. It is holding against the Tide that will back him up. Can't afford to get sloppy right here.
Holding, number 73 on offense. 10-yard penalty from the previous spot. Down remains first.
Yeah, Vallejo's tried to move his feet and did a pretty good job, but there at the last second, they just, FIU defender got in front of him a little bit and he pulled him down.
Richardson tiptoeing the sidelines, and Tyler, he got about four more yards than most mortal men would have gotten in that situation, able to keep himself in bounds and make a nice gain.
Doing a great job. Look at Smelly. Drew Davis over there on the side, allowing him to get to the edge.
About the balance to stop on a dime, literally. In tightrope things, back to the original line of scrimmage. So second and 10 now for Alabama. Smelly the H-back, Richardson the tailback. He'll get the carry, he'll get running room, he'll get the first down, and he'll also get over 100 yards rushing now on the night for the true freshman out of Escambia High School in Pensacola, Florida. Finally brought down by Desiriah Johnson, but not until the damage was done.
No, I tell you what, though, that left side of the line did a great job. The pressure was coming from their side, so the line was slanting away, and they picked it up great, created that crease for him to run through.
Look at those guns. Tyler Watts had guns like that. He'd have worn the jersey tucked underneath as well, right?
That's right.
Very few have guns like that or legs like Ingram's, and he'll take it the distance for an Alabama touchdown. 42 yards, Terry Grant, 2-9, not 2-2. And Terry Grant gives Alabama a 39-14 lead.
That had to have felt good for Terry Grant. It's been a long time coming for old number 29. Does a good job running through the arm tackles there at the line of scrimmage, and he does have a lot of speed.
And meant as a compliment, he looked like Ingram. Tell you what, that young man has changed his body type since he first got on campus. He's not just a speed guy now, like so many others. The weight program, the conditioning, led by Alabama's Scott Cochran, the head football strength and conditioning coach, changing the look of the players individually, and in the process, the change of the look of this Crimson Tide program. 40-14, Tide leading it big. Alabama, which led by only six at the half, stretching that lead out with 8:21 to go in the quarter, capped by Terry Grant's 42-yard touchdown run, three plays, 54 yards on the drive. Got to go back to the Western Kentucky game of 2008 for Terry Grant's last touchdown. Two carries, 39 yards, and Nick Saban was praising him this week. There's a reason why he was used at wideout and is still considered a running back for Alabama. He loves his attitude. He loves how hard he's worked. There were so many rumors at the end of last year that Terry Grant was going to transfer to a lower division school so he could play, and instead, he toughed it out, stuck around, and is a major part of the plans for this Alabama offense.
Yeah, and the way that Alabama rotates running backs, always wanting fresh legs in there, he will get some opportunities. He'll get some plays, and now moving him to that slot receiver, especially with this new package that Alabama has, he can get several touches throughout the course of the year.
Talked about the guys from Florida, Georgia, Texas, Mississippi, the home for Terry Grant, Lumberton High School in Lumberton, Mississippi, where he played his prep ball. They're from all over the country, and they wear the crimson proudly. Hilton almost broke another one, as he did in the first quarter, to really keep FIU in the ball game through the half, but very slowly and methodically, Alabama now pulling away.
Tyrone King making a touchdown-saving tackle. You saw Hilton and Javier Arenas joking just how close he was.
Didn't get Wayne Younger see his numbers from a year ago. And it looks like the evening is now done for Paul McCall. And his numbers aren't great. His team is going to lose tonight. But played a nice ball game, a very gutty performance from the fifth-year senior quarterback. Well, handed off and not much running room there. And some new faces in the game now for Alabama. Drake Kirkpatrick, who we've seen a lot in special teams in the game, along with that man, Kerry Murphy. What a tough offseason in the beginning of camp for Kerry Murphy. Great prospect coming out of Hoover High School, went to Hargrave Military Academy, a freshman whose brother was so tragically murdered just at the start of preseason camp. It was not an easy preseason for Alabama. A few distractions, but the Tide has weathered it and gotten into the year as Younger is going to be stopped by Mark Barron. And that's the thing. You know, talk about it all the time. Those that have participated in athletics, you understand that you learn lessons from that that help prepare you for life. Working through adversity is a major, major part of it. You hear Nick Saban talk about it all the time, and that's what his team is trying to learn under some very trying circumstances.
That's a little more difficult, though, than coming off a loss.
No question. McClain slinging Dariot Perry to the turf. It is a first down, however. And FIU will maintain possession. Tyler, this is a team I think has got a chance to win some games. They were 5-7 a year ago. They lost a couple of heartbreakers that would have made them bowl eligible. And they feel like this is a year with a fifth-year senior at quarterback, 10 of 11 starters back on offense, that they can be a contender in the Sun Belt Conference. They'll play at Rutgers next week, and then it's Toledo coming to Miami to take on FIU. But some winnable games after that. Pass. Is it caught? No, it's not. Incomplete. Trying to go to Greg Ellingson again. But it does fall incomplete. And you've got an injured player down for Alabama. That appears to be Damian Square, who is being attended to by the Alabama medical staff. Jeff Allen, the head athletic trainer. May have just been a cramp for the big fella out of Houston, Texas as well. Hopefully that is all it is. Unfortunately, that excellent medical staff for the University of Alabama has been busy tonight. Again, you hope nothing severe, but Julio Jones went out after the first quarter with some sort of leg injury. He had some ankle issues in the offseason, preseason. You also had Roy Upchurch leave the game in the first half and did not come back. Don't know what type of injury or, again, the severity there. But you hope it's just the typical nicks and bruises that you're going to come up with over the course of the college football season, and you can get them healed quickly.
Yeah, but as you mentioned, go ahead and pull them out of the game. You've got other young talent you're wanting to play anyhow. See what they can do.
Because it is so early in the year, do you have a better chance of coming back from an injury than you do later in the year? Are you fresher? I mean, I would think so. But I know it depends on the type of injury and the severity of it. Well,
I think mentally it helps out, and you do have more time because you have more weeks. You know, all of a sudden, if a two-week injury at the 10th game is not good.
True.
But second game of the season, obviously, you bounce back. But, I mean, that's common sense.
Just a chance, I guess. Body's a little fresher.
Yeah.
Not as worn down and having an injury on top of it.
And rest helps so much, and you're more rested at the beginning of the season and stronger than you are at the end.
And again, Nick Saban, I think, had wanted to play a lot of different guys in this ball game, and he did so early, maybe for a different reason. Injuries altered that a little bit. But as Alabama looks ahead for its next ball game, North Texas, a team that very easily could be 2-0 coming here, an explosive offense. Started to get things going there in Denton, Texas, just outside of Dallas. Second and 10, Nico Johnson in the game for Alabama. Pressure coming. They go to Hilton, and it's broken up nicely. Corey Reamer in there, Tyrone King. Also helping out Nick Gentry. Reamer out of Hoover High School, senior. Another young man that has fought through a lot. Position changes throughout his career. And that's the part a lot of people don't realize, especially on defense. When your position changes, you really have to almost change your body type, add a lot more weight in some cases, as Reamer had to do. Pass across the middle, caught. And then almost taken away by Ali Sharif. In fact, he's trying to hang on. But the possession will indeed go to FIU's Colt Anderson, the tight end.
Colt Anderson was a quarterback coming out of high school. And you talk about a guy changing positions, had to bulk up to play tight end.
Younger has the snap go through his hands. He'll pick it up and running for his life. And a flag comes in. I think somebody from Alabama may have gotten a hand on a face mask. As the Sharks were circling, may have committed a penalty, and I think that's exactly what will be called here against the Tide. Big break for the Golden Panthers with 5:46 to go.
And you definitely don't want to give up any more points.
Personal foul, grasping the face mask on the defense. Penalty is 15 yards from the previous spot. Automatic, first down.
Penn Wage was asked, what was the number? He said, I don't know, there's five of them there.
So a break for the Golden Panthers, and we will see if they can turn that into points.
Look how much lower the practice jerseys are than the game jerseys. It's a good farmer's tan these guys got going on.
From the Alabama 21-yard line. They've only scored one offensive touchdown tonight, although they've gotten one in special teams. Looking for a score there, and a great play by Robbie Green to break it up. Robbie Green got a hand in there, the sophomore out of John Curtis Christian School in New Orleans. Actually, John Curtis, I believe in Baton Rouge, he is, though, from New Orleans and able to knock that one away.
Tell you what, now, he waited to the last moment to turn around. That's exactly what you want your defensive backs to do.
So now second and 10. Younger keeping it, had the option, decided to tuck it, and picked up 2 or 3 yards and paid a big price in the process. Luther Davis in there, also the man running off the field, Kerry Murphy. It is a long season, and you've also got a lot of talent on this Alabama offense and defense. So playing time early to build confidence, to build depth, so important. Because you're going to need them in a 12 and you hope 13 and 14 game season if you're Alabama. 3rd and 7 for FIU. Got to get to the 11. Younger with time. Looking for the end zone. Broke it up. Chris Rogers, I believe, got a hand on it. He did. Talked about Rodgers a lot in special teams, but able to work his way onto the field defensively and comes up with a great play.
Yeah, and he was stride for stride with wide receiver for FIU. That's Marquise Roll. It's great coverage.
Rodgers, the senior out of Evangel Christian in Lakeland, Florida. Had a couple of block punts his career. That is not a good sign. And Tyler, you kind of mouthed to me. You thought it might be the ankle. And judging from the way Damian Square is being carted off the field to the Bama locker room, you would think it was certainly much more than a cramp. Ball batted around. Mark Barron's got it. And Alabama turns away FIU again. Barron returns it to the 31. Golden Panthers may have gotten away with a hole, but it didn't matter.
Good pressure up the middle. Ball might have gotten deflected even. And Barron was there. That's exactly what these fans and what these other guys wearing crimson wanted to see.
Mark Barron, the sophomore out of St. Paul's down in Mobile. And Thomas Dara will come in at quarterback now for the Crimson Tide. He'll hand it off to Terry Grant, who cuts it back. Grant spinning and finally out of bounds. Knocked out across the 45, Thomas Dara, a walk-on at the University of Alabama from Noonan High School in Noonan, Georgia. 6'5", 227. And he is listed as the backup along with Star Jackson, but also Star picked the wrong week, come down with a flu.
He did.
Missed some practice time early in the week, and Thomas Dara getting an opportunity to play here tonight. Low snap, picked up nicely, and a great reaction by Grant. Trying to get to the corner, lowers his shoulder, and will be brought down back at the 47-yard line, but still Tyler was able to turn that into a 5 or 6 yard pickup.
It was a great run by Grant. Yeah, I think the low snap initially is probably what caused this to happen. There's not a whole lot going on there to the play side, but it's a good job. You've seen a wore-out defense, though. Not pursuing allows them to get all the way to the backside.
And the proverbial dogs, in one sense, have indeed been called off. You got another running back in the game, Demetrius Goode, who will see action. Sophomore, 5'9", 191, out of LaGrange, Georgia. Bama keeping it on the ground, and a nice play there by FIU is making the stop. Jonathan Cyprian, the 6-foot freshman, able to make the hit. We saw Goode get in the game a couple of times last year, may have been against Auburn in the rout of the Tigers, 36-0. We saw him get some playing time.
Got a new offensive line in as well.
Barron Huber in as the H-back. Don't really have a true fullback in this Alabama offense. Give you as many names as we can. As Grant gets close to the first down mark, but I think he's going to be just shy of that. Alfred McCullough among the new linemen in the game. Tyler Love, offensive lineman in there. Michael Williams at tight end. Alabama may go for it right here. John Michael Boswell out of Tuscaloosa County High, just across the river in Northport. Saw a lot of action last year. David Ross out of Homewood. New right guard in the game as well. Chance Warmack is a guy that there's a lot of excitement about in terms of his future at Alabama. The give to Grant right up the gut. He's got the first down and more. Tell you what, that'll help those young guys, Tyler, going into this next week. Something that they can hang their hat on. Getting the job done, and also we'll see a third quarterback see playing time now for Alabama as Dara will check out, and Star Jackson will come in to replace him. Jackson, a redshirt freshman out of Lake Worth High School in Lake Worth, Florida, seeing his first action in a game for the Crimson Tide. Along with Demetrius Goode, they'll work him from the shotgun on first and 10. They'll hand it off, and Goode bounces it to the outside. Good near the first down mark. We'll see where they spot it. That is enough. Stopping the clock with 103 and a 40-14 Alabama lead that's very, very comfortable.
I believe we've seen the same play three plays in a row right now, but it's worked every time. Keep running it. They're wanting to keep the ball on the ground and run the clock out, but give these guys meaningful opportunities to move the football.
Michael Williams, the redshirt freshman tight end out of Pickens County High and Reform, Alabama. Running interference. Michael Bowman, a wide out in there. Jackson, the give. Good once again. And he'll get to the 20-yard line. A gain of five, maybe six. Alabama will have to snap it one more time. What they choose to do with it will be at the discretion of head coach Nick Saban.
Well, you don't want to take a knee, because then Starr would have negative 2 yards rushing.
Yeah, I'm sure that's really at the front of Nick Saban's mind right now. Over 500 yards of total offense tonight for the Crimson Tide is good. We'll get the final carry, you would think, for Alabama. As the clock will continue to run, and that will be enough for Alabama. They will move the chains, but once they do, the clock will start again, and the handshakes will ensue on the sidelines. Coaches will meet at midfield. Nick Saban and FIU's Mario Cristobal exchanging pleasantries as Alabama wore down the Golden Panthers, who gave the Tide all they wanted for the first 30 minutes, but Bama pulled away for the 40-14 victory. Barry Krause will talk with Tide head coach Nick Saban.
Offensively, special teams control position. So, you know, we played like a football team in the second half. I really wasn't pleased with the way we played in the first half. And we thought, well, you know, we've known Trent was an outstanding player. He got a little more opportunity in this game than last week and certainly showed that he could do it. You know, Roy got nicked up early, and Mark's been sick all week, so he was a little bit under the weather. But Trent did a great job for us. Time, but we practiced it all week. Felt like our players were a little bit out in the first half and do a good job in what they do. And the quarterback did a good job, especially. All right, thank you.
Thank you, Barry. Thank you, Coach. Thank you, Trent Richardson. 15 carries, 118 yards, two touchdowns, and Tide eventually able to pull away from the Golden Panthers of FIU. 40-14 is your final as Bama piles up 516 yards of total offense. An impressive night for the offense. The defense holds off the Golden Panther attack. Next up, North Texas here in T-Town. For Tyler Watts, Barry Krause, and our entire Crimson Tide Sports Network crew, I'm Chris Stewart. Thanks so much for joining us. Roll Tide, and good night from the Capstone.